Many people interested in foreign policy have told me when they come to the Indian Council of World Affairs in Sapru House, they feel a great sense of affinity with this institution because this was where the serious study of international relations in India all began.
The ICWA was set up by a small group of public intellectuals some years before our independence, because they felt it important that India have an independent perspective on international affairs. Since then, the ICWA has gone from strength to strength, and it has been a long journey, almost 75 years. One particular milestone in that journey was in 2001, when the Indian Parliament passed an act declaring the ICWA to be an institution of national importance. We thus became a publicly funded independent think tank. Our governing council is headed by the Vice President of India, and the External Affairs Minister is its Vice President. We have three focus areas. The first is research, which is carried out by an in-house faculty. Very rigorous research of different parts of the world, encompassing the domain of area studies.
The Council has been very proactive in conducting dialogue and discussion on African affairs and India-Africa relations in order to promote an understanding on African affairs in India, an Indian perspective on Africa, given the priority that now Africa has in Indian foreign policy.
Within the Council, we have a renewed focus on Latin America and the Caribbean region. So we're looking through our studies to find new areas of cooperation such as renewable energy, climate change, and this space technology.
Interacting with leading experts, diplomats, media persons, and academicians has helped me nurture my research further.
We recently had the ASEAN Indo-Pacific Outlook, which has a lot of convergence with the India's own Indo-Pacific construct.
The learning curve at the Council has been tremendous, and it provides a strong foundation for my future research.
The second is policy. Because we are a think tank, and being close to policy, commenting on policy, and helping formulate policy is an essential part of our functioning.
I think in the new age, what we're seeing much, much more of is that people want to be involved in foreign policy thinking. They want to have a voice. Now, this is where ICWA comes in.
This is the platform where I, for many years, have come and interacted with the best in the world.
ICWA provides a valued platform for visiting foreign dignitaries to interact with informed Indian audiences. The third is outreach. This is most important because of our role as a public-funded independent think tank, and we carry this out by associating ourselves with as wide an audience in India as is possible. Colleges, universities, other think tanks, and of course, with similar institutions elsewhere in the world.
What I would call the democratization of Indian foreign policy. It has moved to distant corners of the country. It is no longer a preserve of Delhi.
ICWA has a robust publications program, which includes papers by the in-house faculty, invited papers and commentaries, and books on foreign affairs by not only former diplomats and established academics, but also by upcoming scholars. Our journal, India Quarterly, is being published since 1945. ICWA's publications are also being translated into various Indian languages. What is ICWA's role as we move into the future? The vision of the institution is to stay abreast of all the momentous changes taking place in the domain of foreign policy. New areas are emerging. There are strategic technologies. There is climate change. There is artificial intelligence. And there is cybersecurity. How can our research faculty and the audiences that come here be better informed about developments in these areas? How can we write and formulate research papers to give policy inputs that help in government policy formulation? These are the emerging challenges for ICWA and form a part of our vision for the future.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all once again on behalf of the Indian Council of World Affairs for the second day of this international conference on Priyam Panikkar and the growth of maritime consciousness in India. We'll begin this day with the session three. The session three is on the epoch of Atlantic power dominance in the Indian Ocean, 15th to 19th century. For the session, we are very pleased to have with us Professor Himanshu Prabhare, former chairperson, National Monuments Authority of India, as the moderator and commentator for the session. Among the speakers, we have Professor Ravi Alin Palat. He's the professor, Department of Sociology, State University of New York. Ms. Amrita Karambelkar, Research Associate, Vivekananda International Foundation, New Delhi. Commodore Odakal Johnson, Director Research, Maritime History Society, Mumbai. Dr. Rohan, Assistant Professor, Department of History, Maitreyi College, University of Delhi. And Dr. Krishnendra Meena, Associate Professor, Center for International Politics, Organizations and Disarmament, Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. Before I hand over to the moderator, some customary house rules. All the participants are requested to mute themselves when they're not speaking. Questions can be asked during the discussion round, and panelists can ask questions by raise hand option. The registered participants can ask questions live by typing through the chat box. In case any of the speakers are facing connectivity issues, they may switch off the camera and continue on the audio mode. May I now invite Professor Ray to conduct the proceedings for the session. Ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Pragya, and a very warm welcome to all of you on this session three, second day of what has been a very interesting conference on KM Panikkar. I'd just like to announce that it's quite late for Professor Ravi Palat. It's 11:30 p.m. For him. And so we will make move away from our established pattern yesterday. We will have his presentation, and we'll have question answers after his presentation, and then we will proceed with the other papers. So those of you in the audience, please send your questions in, and do send them on chat or in Q&A. We will take them up as soon as Professor Palat's presentation is over. I think it's also right, because he's the one who talks about the Atlantic and Atlantic dominance, whereas the other papers generally deal with the period from 1500 to 1900. As Pragya mentioned, Professor Palat is teaching at Binghamton. He's a professor of sociology, State University of New York at Binghamton. And he's a very well-known scholar. He's had a long innings in teaching and research. So over to you, Professor Palat.
Thank you so much. I'm glad to be at this conference, and I must apologize beforehand that I will have to leave soon after my presentation rather than listen to the other papers, because it is very late and tomorrow is a teaching day. I have to be back lecturing. So forgive me for that. And I hope some of these video records are there so that I can watch it later. I wanted to talk about the impact of the Americas on Asia, which has not been adequately theorized. And I stumbled upon it when I was reading something by Octavio Paz, the Mexican writer who went on to win the Nobel Prize in literature. But before he won the Nobel Prize, he had been his country's ambassador to India. And when he arrived in New Delhi, he saw our curries, meat or vegetables in brown sauce. And he wondered if it was, there was a similarity between our curries and the Mexican mole, which is a sauce of cloves and cardamom and coriander and sometimes chocolate, another brown sauce with meat and vegetables. And he saw we were eating with rotis, the Mexicans were eating with burritos and tortillas, which he called edible spoons. And he wondered whether there was a gastronomic geography between two countries on opposite sides of the planet. When Octavio Paz wrote that, he probably did not know that the first recorded Asian to have landed in Mexico was an enslaved slave of the first bishop of New Spain, a man named Juan de Zumarraga, and his enslaved cook was named Juan Nunez and was supposed to be from Calicut. But that is an anecdote. It is not so much of Indian or Mexican influence for each other's cooking. But what I want to look at was the impact of the Americas on early modern Asia, even if it is recognized. Today we hear a lot about chilies and potatoes and tomatoes and all that coming from the Americas to India and other parts of Asia. We hear about the bullion coming in the coin hoards of the Mughals, etc., also from the Americas. But this has not, even though this is recognized, it has not been theorized. In contrast to the Europe, where the importance of the Americas in the development of capitalism has long been recognized. In 1944, Eric Williams, who went on to become the first prime minister of Trinidad and Tobago, wrote a book called Capitalism and Slavery. 30 years later, in the early 70s, the brilliant young Guyanese historian Walter Rodney wrote, and I'm quoting him, "It would have been impossible to open up the new world and to use it as a constant generator of wealth had it not been for African labor. There were no other alternatives. The Native American population was virtually wiped out, and Europe's population was too small for sufficient settlement overseas at that time. Then, having become utterly dependent on African labor, Europeans at home and abroad found it necessary to rationalize the exploitation in racist terms as well." This insight of the historians of the Caribbean had been obscured in the transition debate in Europe, the feudalism to capitalism debate, which we had learned when I was in India at the JNU and elsewhere. Nothing of this came through. It was resuscitated about 20 years after Rodney by the Peruvian sociologist Anibal Quijano, who wrote an article with Wallerstein arguing that it was the ability of Europeans to get wealth from the Americas by subordinating the Native Americans with African and using African labor to gather the wealth to create the centralized states in Europe and establish capitalism. But in this, they ignored the importance of Asia. While they could not ignore the importance of the flows of bullion to Asia, especially because there was the Manila galleon, which brought in the silver from Acapulco to Manila. This was written off as the exchange, that money which was put into jewelry, put into temples, and not used commercially. They did not understand the wide-ranging consequences of the influence of bullion into areas that were chronically short of coinable metals. Approached from another angle, the angle of Indian and Chinese history, the links to the Americas have also been marginalized. K.M. Panikkar's Asia book itself talks about the Vasco da Gama era as the beginnings of Western dominance. He talks about early on in the book about the, and I'm quoting again, the imposition of a commercial economy over communities whose economic life in the past had been based not on international trade, but mainly on agricultural production and internal trade. Yet rather than seeing this blossoming of trade as undermining the political economies of Asia, I want to suggest that it led to an efflorescence of commercial activity and industriousness, which shaped a process of socio-economic development which is distinct from capitalism. mesmerized by historical scholarship has been by capitalism as a teleological goal. Explorations have been on why societies in Asia were not more successful in becoming early capitalist economies, rather than on the political economies they actually did develop. The inflows of bullion from Americas through the agency of Europeans have been documented both by European sources and by the coin hoards we find in India. But the implications of these circuits for the expansion of the circuits of exchange have not been fully explored. The shift of tax collection from taxes in kind to money, I am arguing, could not have been possible without large inflows of gold and silver, silver to the north from the Americas. In China, the single whip reform of 1570, which consolidated a whole host of levies into one single tax, while it took some time to establish, could not have been possible without the inflows of American and Japanese silver. That these developments were important for the development of market relations in both zones, in China and India. The peasants and craftsmen had to sell their produce to pay taxes. This created a vast network of commercial networks which spanned the oceans, spanned the seas. The botanical bounties of the Americas also reshaped lives, everyday life, by changing diets and regional cuisines. Most impressively, till the 16th century, the Chinese population never broke through a ceiling of 100 to 150 million people. But after the introduction of crops from the Americas, especially maize, potato, and a sweet potato, it was estimated to reach 400 million by the end of the 18th century. The absence of a similar population explosion in India also illustrates differences between China and India, and I'll come to that in a bit. Starting at least from the works of Charles Boxer, some historians have argued that the establishment of Manila as a Spanish entrepot in 1571 led to a globally integrated economy. But I want to suggest that this did not lead to a similar pattern of socio-historical development across the globe. And one instance of this is the size of economic decision-making units in Europe and its colonies in the Americas on the one hand, and those in Asia on the other, which evolved in opposite directions between the 16th and the mid-18th centuries. In Europe and the Americas, these became the larger the slave plantations, the second serfdom, the large joint stock companies with monopoly rights, enclosures in agriculture. Only these units had the resources to respond optimally to conditions presented by the market and accumulate capital. In much of continental Asia and Japan, on the other hand, the size of economic decision-making units grew progressively smaller and did not offer an economic advantage for the accumulation of capital. To take just one instance, in the early 17th century, when sugar began to be exported from Guangdong to Japan and other parts of East Asia, the cultivation was in the hands of small-scale farmers, unlike the large sugar plantations worked by slaves in the Caribbean. So what I want to suggest is that the impact of interactions with the Americas was conditioned by the very different constitution of the varied historical systems in Europe and Asia. Mao Zedong had an interesting expression. He said, the internal constitution conditions the impact of external causes. He said, in a suitable temperature, and I'm quoting him, an egg changes into a chicken in an incubator, but no temperature can change a stone into a chicken, because each has a different internal basis. What I want to suggest is that historical systems based on wet rice cultivation absorbed the inflows of bullion and new crops based on their own dynamics rather than based on the logic of capitalism. In Europe, the bounties of the Americas enabled nascent capitalists and rulers to wrest the livelihoods of rights of livelihood that peasants and workers, townspeople, had tenaciously won over the centuries. It created large economic units that could respond positively to market conditions and lead to a more optimal accumulation of capital. Precisely because economies based on wet rice cultivation generated large volumes of surplus, state builders did not have to rely on merchants and financiers for their protection providing activities. There was no compulsion to grant them monopolies. The ability of wet rice economies to support large, much larger densities of population generated expansive circuits of exchange and promoted labor-intensive methods of cultivation rather than capital-intensive methods. There was little advantage to be gained by capital accumulation, and the logic of capital accumulation did not dominate their social system. It did not, unlike in Europe, where there's a mutually beneficial alliance between state builders and financiers, there was no such alliance in much of continental Asia. This is not to argue that there were no rich capitalists or even individual capitalists, but that there was no pressure to create monopolies. And it is large volumes of capital that are accumulated under monopolies which create capitalism rather than the sphere of market economy. Giovanni Arrighi, the Italian sociologist and political economist, said, and I'm quoting him, add as many capitalists as you like to a market economy, but unless the state has been subordinated to their class interest, the market economy remains non-capitalist. I've got about 5 minutes, 7 minutes. Both China and India were based largely on wet rice economies, they were structured differently. And one difference you see is in the political unity of China and the political disunity of the Indian subcontinent. In the Indian subcontinent, the juxtaposition of fertile river valleys and expansive dry lands, where military entrepreneurs had a comparative advantage, led to the fact that you had dense forests which limited nomadic penetration into the subcontinent. And so we have kings of kings, Raja the Raja, Shah in Shah, rather than a king of India. And this had two important consequences. In China, the imperial bureaucracy could use imported plants from the Americas to promote settlement of lands which were unsuitable for crops of the Eastern Hemisphere. The political unity of the empire enabled the state to increase migrations. The historian of China, Jonathan Spence, said, and I quote him again, the crucial importance of the new plants was not that they provided a variety for either the poor or the rich, though they did that, but that they allowed a population that had reached the limits of its traditional resources to expand anew. The lack of a pan-Indian polity and much lower demographic pressures may have been a barrier to the spread of new subsistence crops except maize. So I want to wind this up and to say that the European colonization of the Americas unarguably inaugurated world history by joining the histories of the two hemispheres together for the first time. Revisionist historians have seized on these interconnections, especially of bullion flows and botanical gardens, botanical exchanges, to counter Fernand Braudel's argument that Europe was a monstrous shaper of world history. More specifically, with the global flows of bullion and commodities, it has been argued that capitalism originated within a common international theater of social and commercial exchanges. David Washburn, people like that. It is not simply a question, therefore, of incorporating more and more areas to a European-based capitalist world economy. This is very similar to proponents of globalization talking about a flat world. All right? The assumption that trade automatically leads to greater integration between different social systems without examining the structures of these systems or structures of power that underlie the new integrated system is to replace the triumphalism of the rise of the West with the triumphalism of globalization. However well-intentioned, revisionist attempts at integrating non-European histories is tantamount to incorporating the rest of the world into a European modernity. It doesn't analyze the specific historical dynamics of social systems outside of Europe. Rather, what we see is that the flows of bullion and crops from the Americas led to two systems of commercialization without capitalism, because economies based on wet rice cultivation did not privilege the accumulation of capital, and the productivity of lands did not compel an alliance between state builders and merchant financiers. As labor-intensive production stifled the development of metallurgy important for weaponry, etc., it ultimately fell victim to the predatory tendencies of European capitalism. And I'll end there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Palat, both on account of bringing the Americas in, and I agree with you that Panikkar does mention very briefly the flow of bullion, but more importantly, for bringing in the discussion on crops, on slaves, and broadening the whole issue from bullion inflow to the human capital and the association of a variety of social groups. Before I go on, I'd like to invite questions, and I don't see anything in the chat. I would really like any of you to ask, who is interested in asking a question, to raise their hands. I'll try and keep track. So are there any questions? So, since I don't see any questions, I'd like to sort of maybe use my position and raise a question myself. Yes, it's the points you make are very well taken, but I was just wondering, in terms of the newer work that talks about what is termed as intercolonial dependency between the Atlantic and the Indian Ocean. And this work, and I'm not sure if you've seen this newer work, this work actually argues that wet rice cultivation, particularly in the two prolific areas of South Carolina, which is seen as a rice bowl in the colonial period, and Burma, which is again seen as a rice bowl in the colonial period, this combination of bringing the two rice bowls of the globe, as it were, under the domination of a colonial state, this led to further use of rice, wet rice, for increase of commodity production, for increase of capital, and provided an impetus to this expansion further. So I was just wondering if you had some thoughts on that. Yes,
I think, but that comes in a much later period. Rice cultivation in South Carolina and in Burma starts in the 18th and 19th centuries. which is where there's a famous saying of the King of Burma's envoy is going to the Sultan of Golconda and saying, my land is bigger, and the Sultan of Golconda saying, I am the king of men and you are the king of mosquitoes. But because of the floodplains of Southeast Asia, Burma could be, Burma and much of mainland Southeast Asia became wetterized. Wet rice cultivation started after water control technologies took place in the 18th and 19th centuries. Whereas otherwise, the kingdoms were in the hilly areas in the interior because they had an advantage of sailing down the rivers to subordinate the peoples there. So excepting island Southeast Asia in Indonesia, where wet rice cultivation took place. So you see that in population distributions today. In the earlier settlements of Asia, where there were the more densely populated settlements of Asia were places where wet rice cultivation took place at an earlier stage. South Carolina, again, it took place under commodity production, under slavery. So that had a very different dynamic.
Thank you. I take your point, and I don't want to press this any further, just to very briefly say that, the whole of Angkor developed, which is 13th century, developed as a result of wet rice cultivation and use of or manipulation of water resources.
Yes,
but let me also take, yeah, let me also
Angkor
take
is different from Burma. Angkor is different from Burma.
That's true. That's true. But, but that's something we can talk about and argue about later on. There are two questions here. One is from Mr. Nair, R.M. Nair. He says, as I understand from your talk, you have detailed the economic effects of the age of Vasco da Gama. I think Portugal's main concern was the loss of political power. The crops that were to be grown and how they were grown, sold, were a consequence of this loss.
Possibly, but initially, when you're talking about the establishment of Ming and Qing China, the Mughals actually were established after Vasco da Gama came. So you have a lot of empires coming in, economic efflorescence in India, in China, and elsewhere. After Vasco da Gama came in, because of the flow of bullion and crops from the Americas. Later on, as I was trying to say, because of the very way in which this economy developed, largely labor-intensive, what people have called the industrious revolution rather than the industrial revolution, then the European weaponry became more important, your European manipulation of steam engine became much more important, and that happened later, but not immediately. And in fact, by Panikkar, while he opens up the issues, he's still working within a framework of European history. In fact, much of our own work in Indian history has been looking at why we were not like Europe. And that is, again, what the Chinese are saying. And my argument is we should look at what is much more common in Asia, right? When I was a student at JNU, we had ancient society, feudalism, capital. It was all looking at Europe, not looking at other parts of the world which are like us.
No, that point is very well taken. And JNU still does ancient society, feudalism, and capitalism. But let me, Commodore Johnson had a question. Commodore Johnson, would you like to ask your question? Please unmute yourself and ask the question. Yeah.
Thank you, Professor Palat, for a very significant communication of what the influence across the Atlantic. But the message somehow your talk conveyed is a general minimalistic impact on economy or trade in the Asian construct. in the 15th to 16th centuries. So the implied question is, so does that mean that age of discovery, what we have been saying, that it was not an age of discovery, there was nothing to discover, is still something of global importance because of maybe just time period, if not the event itself?
We can't hear you, Professor Palat. You have to unmute yourself.
Okay. I think that the European voyages linked the both the hemispheres. So that is of extraordinary significance. And I don't say that it was a minor significance, because I think the flows of bullion actually was very vital.
Thank you.
Yes. Other questions? May I then follow up on what Commodore Johnson has said, and I think Professor Palat, you've said it also in response to the earlier question, where you said that the model within which we study history, we study Indian history. Let's stick to Indian history. This model is a European construct, or a model based on the way in which Europeans saw the world, right? And we have sort of put in, you know, our two penny bits and said, okay, you know, we were here and there and so on. There was enough to suggest that these connections, you are right about bullion, but clearly bullion didn't come on as a sort of uniform all across Asia, all across all the place cities. You know, I mean, there was a sort of chronological movement to this bullion. And I'm just sort of taking up on whether we need to, I agree, we need to dump that European history. But in that process of dumping, are we not again giving very great significance to Vasco da Gama's discovery, which I think needs to be placed in a much more what was happening in India in the 15th and 16th century, not just the Mughals, the Vijayanagar Empire, which I think you worked on earlier. And so that's really what I would like. But sorry, before I don't want to dominate this. I think there was a question from Dr. Sanjeev Kumar, who says, how do you see the century of humiliation in China in the context of your presentation? Whether the century of violence, conflict, warlordism, and civil war affected commercialization differently?
Yes, but I was talking before that happened. I was talking about the period till the 18th century. So once the Opium War started and all of that happened, but my point was that because of the way the economy was developing, there wasn't a great pressure to develop metallurgy, for instance. It was much more of an industrious type of thing. So the Chinese developed the gunpowder, but they didn't develop the guns to shoot it very, very well. The sailing ships, they could not move, they did not attempt to use steam for their ships. So that type of technology comes in with a particular type of capital intensive method, which happened in Europe but not in Asia, and that is what led to the defeat of the Chinese, the century of humiliation, etc.
Okay. Well, I would have a counter position, but never mind. Yeah. I don't think I'd like to. You know, I mean, weaponry, where would you put this whole thing of, steel, which India was famous for? And you have early references to that. It's hard to, I agree with your point about the scale, and that, you know, industrialization really expanded the scale. But I also think that is, since we don't have the kind of data that we have for later periods, it's difficult to really quantify the production in Asia as compared to what was happening in a later period.
I mean, we had good artisans who could copy stuff, yes, very clearly. But the development of weaponry was also very different in Europe. And we could copy those. We got the European gunsmiths, we copied them, etc. But the development actually took place elsewhere.
Oh, yes.
The invention.
I don't see any further questions. And are there any questions from the panel? And if not, then I'd like to close the session. Thank Professor Palat for starting us off on this very bright and energized note, which got a lot of questions and which got a lot of people interested in asking the questions. So thank you very much. Thank you very much for staying up very late and
thank you.
And presenting this your paper.
Bye.
Okay. And we'll move on.
Hi to Raghavan.
Sorry?
I was just saying hi to Raghavan.
Okay. So
he was my classmate.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yes. Okay.
Bye. Yeah. So we say thank you once again to Professor Palat, and then we move on.
Okay.
And the next four papers will be presented one after the other, and we will have the question answers and the discussion later on. The next paper is by Ms. Amrita Karambelkar, and she is a research associate at the Vivekananda International Foundation here in New Delhi. She's working on her PhD, as I understand it, and I hope I've got it right. She's going to talk to us on the beginning of the epoch, the beginning of the Portuguese period in the Indian Ocean, 1498 to 1660. So 25 minutes, Amrita, is that fine? 25 minutes?
That's fine.
Okay, the floor is yours then.
Thank you very much, Chair, and a very good morning to all of you. And I would like to especially compliment the ICWA for organizing this conference. As someone who studied geopolitics, KM Panikkar was barely part of our syllabus anywhere. So this was a great opportunity to study this and understand his views on India's maritime destiny. Now, my presentation is going to be from the premises of sea power and the entire where Panikkar stands out in terms of analysis of colonial history is that he's analyzing this from the framework of sea power. The colonization in India has been studied from an economic perspective or how it affected our society or in terms of military, but distinctly how the notion of sea power, how that has come to shape India's destiny is something unique, and this is where Panikkar's contribution is valuable. Now, the very through his thoughts, we see his ideas about Indian Ocean, and we get insights into how Indian defenses or maritime defenses can be organized. Now, there are again a few changes from Panikkar's initial thoughts. He was writing this in pre-independence India era. Thereafter, we've seen process of decolonization. We have newer nation states around us. The United Nations law, the UNCLOS was not in existence then. So in these lights, the premises have to be analyzed. I'll move on to the core of my presentation now, that the core idea about Panikkar's entire thesis on Indian Ocean had to do with sea control and how the loss of sea control, India's sea control, Indian rulers' sea control led to eventual colonization. Now, if you see that in India, we have seen this defense, this debate about continental defense or maritime defense and what is more important. But as a post-independent state, our threats have always come from the northern borders, be it China or in Pakistan. So we have sort of neglected a maritime domain. So where Panikkar's work comes into being that as you know, as much as our northern threats are very serious to us, neither of it has the potential to alter India's destiny in the way colonization did. And that colonization came to us from the seafront. So that always needs to be reckoned into the minds of strategic makers. Now, according to Panikkar, the period from 5th to 13th century, which he calls as the period of the Hindu supremacy, was a period when Indians had absolute control over the Indian Ocean. Now, Cholas and Srivijayas were the main two major Hindu empires, and there was a rivalry between them. Now, they fought with each other for about 100 years, and by 13th century, Chola power had started to decline. And with that, eventually also the Srivijayan empire also started to decline because they were fighting for so many years. So and with that decline, they lost their sea control. Now, what happened is that with loss of sea control, they lost the control of the trade that was happening in the Indian Ocean. The trade supremacy was lost, and then it paved way for Muslim supremacy in the Indian Ocean. So Arabs became Arabs monopolized trade from India to Europe. Now, till this time, it was still fine because the Arab intent was mainly commercial. All they wanted to do was trade, and there was never an attempt to politicize or exert political control on India. So things sort of remained the way they were. Then we have to understand amongst these as to why Portuguese came to India. So general understanding was that it was, you know, when it comes to understanding British colonization, that we say that it had to do with industrial revolution in Europe and how the need for colonies. With Portuguese, it was slightly different one. It was, of course, much earlier into the time. But there were two factors, according to Panikkar, that led Portuguese to come to India. There was underlying a crusading spirit against the Muslims. That played a role. Christianity and, as you are aware, Christianity and Islam were fighting in Europe, and both were trying to undercut each other. So according to Portuguese, the one way they could actually undermine Muslim authority is to break their source of power. And the source of Muslim power at that time was their trade, the monopoly of the trade that they enjoyed with India and Indonesia. Second factor in this has to do with the spice trade. Spices had become very, very important for Europeans. It was a valuable commodity. And again, Arabs had full control of spice trade. Now, at this time, Portuguese were at the forefront of crusades, and which was another enabler for them to come to India. Panikkar puts a very interesting facet here, which is the trade competition was not just between, say, Christians and the Muslims, but even intra-Europe, which is Venice and Genoa. And I won't go too much into details of those, but Genoa is more, their dynamics is where Portuguese sort of inherited the Genoese tradition, that inheritance of exploration of trying to explore, get and trade monopoly. Now, there was Muslim control also in the northern African region. And the whole quest of Portuguese exploration was to find an alternative route to India. They wanted to bypass the Mediterranean and the Red Sea. So one way was to find around Western Africa, which they led a lot of expeditions. The first one was in 1291. Where they eventually managed to reach the equator, and eventually, from 1487 was the last successful expedition thereafter, which paid way for Vasco da Gama's arrival. Now, this is where Panikkar says that Vasco da Gama's period has been hailed as a major maritime breakthrough or a major achievement. But Panikkar differs on this, saying that this was hardly anything. Vasco da Gama was merely tracing what was already underway in Portuguese policy for the last 200 years. Even when it comes to, say, exploration of sea routes or finding alternative routes or in terms of pure navigational skills, there is no exception or there's nothing commendable about European discovery because Indians were already doing that. Indians are even Asians. So we see that Indians had contact with Europe much before that, directly, indirectly. Indians knew to sail up to Mozambique Channel. In fact, when Vasco da Gama came. So the Portuguese knew how to round off about Cape of Tempest, which is later called as Cape of Good Hope, and they knew how to sail up to Mozambique. And from Mozambique to India, they had to take help of an Indian sailor. So from there, so Indians were very well versed with this area. They knew all the way across the Malaccas, also to Pacific. So Indians had great naval supremacy at the sea. Now, so how is it that Portuguese were able to consolidate their power? And this is a very interesting and slightly, there are too many nuances to this phase. The first thing we see is that the Portuguese had a common interest. You know, the local Hindu rulers and Portuguese found a common interest, similar to the crusading spirit, so to say, that both had common sort of enemy in Muslim rulers. So the Vijayanagar Empire had had threat from the Bahamani Empire, and they were constantly warring with them. The Portuguese had similar intentions, so they sort of had, you know, a partnership towards this common goal. Which is why Portuguese presence was not really seen as a problem. In fact, it was seen as an alliance, to put it very crudely. Second thing with the Portuguese, they bought firepower and armaments, which were not there in subcontinent by that time. Also, Portuguese could provide horses for the cavalry. That was another factor that sort of allowed forced us understanding between local rulers and the Portuguese. Now, the only exception, another factor was that when it comes to actual trade, for the Indians, it did not really matter who was carrying out their trade, whether it was Arab or it was the Portuguese. For them, it was not a relevant issue. The exception to this was the kingdom of Calicut and the Zamorin. The Zamorin state's entire prosperity was based on their trade with Arabs, which the Portuguese were trying to disrupt. And which is why you see that, you know, Zamorin's policy towards Portuguese was much, much different. I will just briefly now talk about sort of wars that they fought. And so there were three phases of the Portuguese power, how they were able to consolidate. One was, again, Albuquerque's expansion, where he was able to exert control in Goa, in Hormuz, and in a few other places, which sort of set the base for Portuguese empire, so to say. The second phase was, again, impacted by developments in Europe, where counter-reformism had its play. And you see signs of other European nations trying to sail to India, trying to, again, challenge the Portuguese monopoly, because the Portuguese monopoly counter-reformism and rise of Protestantism was not valid anymore. So again, the Dutch wanted to access the trade. So that sort of challenge started happening during the second phase. And in the third phase, we see complete dismantling of the Portuguese power. Now, I'll quickly come to how were the wars that were fought. Now, if you see Albuquerque's strategy, he wanted to establish base in India from where he could master the Indian seas and also establish control in the Malacca Strait, which would enable control of the trade in the Indian Ocean. But despite all of this, Portuguese were really not able to control Indians or the Indian area in the way British have done. And what was the reason for that? Now, it has to do with our coastal defenses. Now, this is where it becomes very interesting. Now, until the arrival of Portuguese, the situation in Indian Ocean was very different. There was what the navies that you had were designed for coastal defenses. So all these navies were, you know, the smaller boats, not much of a firepower, and the combat was still very old style, very what you call as melees in naval sense of terms, where you're still fighting with your swords and all of that. And mostly these navies, the purpose of navy was for amphibious operations, because all your wars were fought on lands. were not fighting C2C. With Portuguese, that changed. Now, Portuguese had bigger ships. They had cannons. They had better firepower, and they were able to sustain all these all of their expeditions because of a fabulous logistical chain. If you are in naval, when it comes to offensive naval operations, your logistic ability plays a very important role. How far you're able to sustain yourself away from your mainland, which the Portuguese were able to do. That is precisely why they could fight so many battles. They could sustain so many battles for about hundreds of years, so far away from their mainland and without any hinterland as such. Yet, despite all of that, Portuguese were not able to defeat Indians or, set their foot on Indian soil in the way the British later did. And that has to do with the naval strategy of the Indians. Now, like I said, the Portuguese ships were heavy and the Indian ships were lighter. So they followed asymmetrical warfare. And the idea was to sort of chase away these bigger vessels. Now, the smaller vessels smaller Indian vessels were large in number, so they would surround the big Portuguese ships, which is why, and they were lot in numbers. What in today's modern warfare you will call as swarming technique, so to say. So because of which, the Portuguese ships were unable to pinpoint direct. Cannon attacks were not possible with the smaller Indian ships. So they would just swiftly come, attack them, sort of create a disturbance in terms of, obstruct their movement from their movement. So that was the strategy. And eventually, for some reason, they could never really get down on the ground or hold ground. They also tried to unsuccessfully set up two blockades of the Calicut. But even that, they were unable to do. And that again had to do with again the smaller ships, and because the bigger ships had a bit of a problem, etc. Now he has how much time do I have left?
Say another seven minutes, all seven, right, 8 minutes.
All right. So I won't go too much into the details about this, but just the Battle of Diu requires a special mention. Now, there was a time when Indians have realized that, this sort of defensive technique is entirely not too useful, and they sought help once from Egypt and once from Turkey. Now, in this battle, in these battles, we see that the Egyptians, in fact, were much better equipped than Portuguese. They had better firepower also. And the lesson we draw from here is that when there are two equal navies that coincide, the one with better seamanship has an upper edge. And this is where the Portuguese lost in this, because they were not as skillful sailors as the Egyptians. Now, in terms of the Battle of Diu, which was very decisive for India, this is where the Egyptians again came to aid of India. But there was treachery that happened, and because of which the Egyptian commander was sort of disgusted and he went back. And during this battle, the Portuguese were able to discover Indian the lacunas in Indian defenses, and which they later exploited. Now, further to come, so what has been the impact of Vasco da Gama epoch? Why is it that it has been called as an epoch? That has to do with so before the Portuguese arrival, Indians and Arabs were trading freely. Indian Ocean was a zone, what we can call today as a zone of complete freedom of navigation. Anybody was allowed to trade anywhere, and except where you had to, there were customary customs, that you had to pay. Besides that, there were no other restrictions. Everybody was free to come, trade and sail. With Portuguese, that completely changed. So Portuguese, when they arrived in the Indian Ocean, they bought their own notion of sea control and sort of see a monopoly of maritime space. Now, this notion was never existing in the Indian Ocean or in Asia by that time. It was seen mostly as what we call today a global commons, in how we understand the law today. But Portuguese conception was territorialization of the maritime space. So they felt just because they have sailed into the Indian Ocean, the entire Indian Ocean becomes theirs. So then they were the ones who introduced the idea of piracy into the Indian Ocean, the attacks on commercial shipping. So this is where we are, and also the forced Indian rulers to sort of enter into these really prolonged, protracted battles. I mean, the battles lasted for about hundreds of years. And while Portuguese never really won in any of these, but it engaged your, constantly warring eventually led to your downfall. Now, what other thing Portuguese bought was that they introduced cannons in the Indian Ocean, and it was quite revolutionary. So with it, it meant that Portuguese had an instant edge over Indians. Now, technology or technological revolutions have always played its part in naval affairs, and Ottomans were the only ones to possess cannons by that time. But by the time Indians could actually was their ability to continuously reinforce their navy. That was another important power which did not exist in Asia by then. Second disruption that the Portuguese brought was an essential political undertone to their trade. Now, Arab mercantile activity until then was strictly economic. So a new power that had great maritime skills, better combat abilities, and an unadulterated political motive had befallen on the coast of India. Now, this was a very noble force to deal with. And even during the period of Hindu supremacy, no Indian power had exercised control over open seas. Even Srivijayan empires could control the Malacca state. So the idea of, until then, the Asian or Indian idea of sea control was to that you control your straits, you control your coastal defenses, but you never really go deeper into the oceans and try to control that. That changed with the Portuguese. And as you know, that since this idea was never there in the subcontinent, so even your navies were designed essentially for coastal defenses. Rather, offensive powers or offensive way of our navies were simply unknown to us. And this, whatever Indian navies you had were also meant for mostly for to fight wars on land, what you call amphibious operations. So which is why this was a big challenge for them to meet a power. And this is something unheard of, because this factor becomes important when we want to assess, what led to our past. Because, in a very common understanding, it is assumed that perhaps Indians were somehow weak. And that is why, they could not defend themselves against colonization. So that was not really true. How do you sort of prepare for something that you never imagined, that has never really happened? And that's a problem we face in military decisions even today. So a Portuguese arrival in that way could be called as a black swan event, so to say. Now, I'll just very quickly run through what do we learn from Panika's analysis for the 21st century. Now, he's again emphasizing the idea of sea control, and his idea of sea control is much different from sea control that we see in Mann's time or what Corbett has written. But still, it is very important for us to understand that how mere reliance on sea denial or sea defense is just not sufficient. Now, great power competition, as it was playing out in the past, is also playing out in Asia even today. And it is happening in areas which are strategically important for India. Now, Panika's thoughts were about the Indian Ocean security were based on the British Indian Ocean territory. But today, South Asia has several independent states. But the value that Panika saw even back then, in terms of control over or influence over Sri Lanka or Hormuz or Oman or East Africa, Indonesia, these ideas remain relevant even today. And if you see the India's current, the current Indian Ocean outlook, it's actually emphasizing all these island states and all these critical nations in our for our defense and security. Now, unlike the 15th century, where enemy attack was aimed at, capturing territory, this sort of threat is unlikely to come to peninsular India. But the threat of territorial occupation at the northern border remains. And while Panikkar has always been has given a lot of emphasis to securing the maritime domain, he also mentioned that, you know, you cannot really neglect continental defenses. And this is where he gives example of Russia and Britain, because the reason why Britain was able to exercise influence on India had to do with because British were able to set their foot on the continental landmass of India. And that is where they were from internally, they were able to exert control. So, and he lists out example as to wherever there have been major wars between a continental power and a maritime power, eventually the continental power has won. So that is a very important lesson for us in India. And to be, you know, frankly, in our situation, we really can't have that sort of a dichotomy whether we want to prioritize continental or the maritime defense. Both ideas are equally important for us. Second, just last point that, you know, Indian naval strategy has always been defensive, and it is, while our admirals back in the time have done a great job, we have to again rethink whether only a defensive strategy is suitable for us. And you cannot have sea control without any offensive capabilities. Now, the peninsular India, the physiography makes blockades very difficult in peninsular India. But with latest technology, you know, which supports precision strike capabilities or ballistic missiles or even laser weapons, undersea warfare, you know, the enemy does not need to enforce blockade in these cases. Now, of course, sea lanes of communication and various choke points can still very well be controlled. Now, the last thing is that until the 17th century, Europeans could not exercise any political control over India. And whenever they've tried, they were defeated. But they were able to establish control over the islands. And from the islands, they were able to somehow continue their political influence. And which is a valuable lesson about criticality of having power on land and safeguarding the islands. And therefore, our focus has, as you see, we see is also towards securing our the islands around us, and India's emphasis on increasing diplomacy into the Indian Ocean island states. I'll end at that. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that fascinating talk. And you've raised several issues, and you know the next two speakers are also going to touch upon them, but in a variety of ways, whether the defense was coastal or, you know, how do we frame that? You talked about logistics, you talked about ships. So I think both Commodore Johnson and Dr. Rohan are also following this up, but of course, from very different perspectives. So we'll come back to the discussion after all these papers, but thank you very much. And may I now request Commodore Odakar Johnson, who is Director of Research at the Maritime History Society in Mumbai. And he's going to talk to us on sea power in shaping of a nation, a case history of 18th century Bay of Bengal. The floor is yours, Commodore Johnson.
Thank you, Chairperson. Let me just share this. Right. Since I have the same screen, let me kind of think. So I hope the PPT is also seen and I'm audible.
Yes, that's fine. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Respected Chairperson, a very dear encourager and mentor, Professor Himanshu Prabha Ray, honored fellow panelists, Team ICWA, led by Dr. Raghavan, participants, greetings from the Maritime History Society. Exactly a year ago, lockdown was a word that entered our lexicon. And I am not focusing on lockdown just because it's a date the Prime Minister had announced. But within months, two among many other organizations were faced with an intellectual challenge. And we did not allow the lockdown to lock our minds, but we found a fresh canvas to stay unrestrained in curating consciousness. It's a term that I have could ascribe to what the ICWA did and my last appearance to present a paper in July. And maritime consciousness, which is part of the title of this conference, which we believe we have set a good path. It has been a good year. However, this morning I woke up to the news that yesterday, a container carrier merchant vessel Evergreen, a 400 meter by 59 meter container ship has blocked the Suez Canal. And it has brought alive the vulnerability of choke points in the idea of the common idea of oceans being unlimited and unfettered. Ocean spaces can also suffer from certain consequences which we normally do not ascribe it. And so it's raised a very typical general alarm. So in that sense, is it consciousness or coincidence or coherence that we are going to talk about Sardar Panikkar and the growth of maritime consciousness in India? Now, allow me, therefore, to very quickly mention what Admiral J.G. Natkarni mentioned in 2007 in a conference. He says, the maritime journey of India perhaps began when a piece of Gondwana was broken and sailed all the way up the Indian Ocean, crashing into the Eurasian plate, creating a maritime geography called India, but maybe did not leave adequate sea-mindedness in the people who inhabit it. Now, my premises, I heard this 14 years ago, and I do not really agree with it in totality. But allow me not to begin with the Panikkar quote, but okay, this is what I plan to do, just to have a little more time, because very interestingly, as my preceding speaker has talked a lot on naval strategy, I'm not going to get caught except in the discussion. I will stick to what I have planned. So this is what I have planned. How has thought and thinking guided sea power through time? What is the oceanic or geopolitical context of the Anglo-French conflict, particularly in terms of timelines and trajectories in the Bay of Bengal? I'll very quickly mention the three Carnatic Wars and related to IR theory kind of bridges my work and my specialization, and close with the idea of a 21st century collaborative paradigm for greater maritime consciousness. So the quote is, the visual is of 17th, 18th century, and the quote is Admiral Sergei Goroshkov. Sea power includes the main components, ocean research and exploitation, status of merchant and fishing fleets, and the ability to meet the needs of the state, and the presence of a navy is to safeguard the interest of a state, since antagonistic social systems exist in the world. I'm just mentioning because thoughts and thinking spread across the globe, eras and backgrounds. So what is my primary aim? Now, the interaction and interplay between international relations and history have traversed terrestrial and maritime routes to evolve over time. As far as India and Indian Ocean is concerned, conceptual evolution of sea power has great relevance in the exchange of culture, establishment of political power, dynamics of society, trade and economics. Important factors for strengthening the economy, technical development and consolidating economic, political and cultural link among continents include sea power. Therefore, the building of a navy and rise of sea power have been the task of generations. Sea power requires a vision construct of a century or more. You do not build sea power in a couple of years. My paper seeks to examine the different facets of the Anglo-French battles off and on the coast of east coast of India in the 18th century. Look at its tryst, India's tryst with sea power in a grand narrative to look at maritime buildup and strategy. I am going to look at tendencies of sea power in a globalized world and look at a conclusion to see what are some emerging perspectives in the maritime domain. So at the outset, it is very apt to reconcile the textual span between the Greek word thalassokratia used by Captain A.T. Mahan in his work, The Influence of Sea Power on History, 1660-1673. And the term flowing from the word nauticon as sea power. Now, before we go into a debate, and I don't intend to, whether it is a split word or a synthesized word, it contains a divergence of emphasis based on the thoughts and thinkers. Andre Lambert in Sea Power states, maritime culture, continental empires and conflict that made the modern world uses a softer identity driven by entities attempting to use the asymmetry of maritime power. And that's what Lincoln Payne mentions in his work in 19. I am attempting to look the decisive and strategic use of sea with all elements with a high focus on building a navy. K.M. Panikkar expounded on the importance of command of the sea, which he says that India historically lost in 16th century. Post-independence, India's maritime outlook has witnessed great change and intentionality. And to further understand the evolution of sea power or aspects of India, one can refer to the work 21st Century Sea Power Guide by Geoffrey Till, where he looks at how sea power is perceived in today's modern context. As an outcome of sea power and strategy, this is what summarizes Sardar Panikkar's case, and people have been talking about it from yesterday. He argues a case for a strong maritime orientation for India. And I yesterday had the privilege of actually rehearing the contents, especially the chair and the other senior eminent scholars, in a high speed. And I have just been happy that I didn't have to change my slide at all. But Panikkar marks the significant date of 1784, which saw French exclusion and the singularity of maritime control transition of India over to Britain. So, an outcome of sea power and strategy on Indian maritime history involves a study of Anglo-French naval and related land-based engagements in the Bay of Bengal region in the 18th century, which are an important factor to study. European powers spread their colonial designs in the later half of the preceding millennium for a decisive influence and benefit on the rich canvas of Indian maritime heritage. The 18th century battles highlight these two significant components: command of the sea and naval operations. To further discuss the trajectory of the Anglo-French sea power, I am going to highlight an oceanic geopolitical context of these four components: the Austrian War of Succession, the First Carnatic War and the Third Carnatic War. The second one was largely continental, but I'll talk about it. And very neglected component, though talked about by Captain Mahan, the battles between Suffren and Hughes in the Bay of Bengal in 1780 to 1783. So that is what is my context. And so a very quick look. One of this has been covered by the preceding speaker. So this is just like a contextualization. 1498 sees Vasco da Gama arrive in Kozhikode. The Portuguese were restricted mainly to Goa. And finally, their focus shifts away from India. 1602, the Dutch East India Company gets chartered. And in their journey, they set up factories in Cochin, Nagapattinam and Agra. Their focus is on spice trade. But 1741, again, a very neglected element, the loss of the Dutch at Kolachal, Martand Verma's victories. And of course, the 1601, the British East India Company was formed. An outpost was created in Surat by 1610, Madras in 1640, Bombay 1668, and by 1698 in Calcutta. On the other hand, the French East India Company is slower. 1664, it's formed. By 1692, Surat, Masulipatam, Pondicherry, and Chandernagar are established. So that's like the beginning. But let me just go through what were the seeds of the Anglo-French conflict in India. In the geopolitical and geographical settings, by early 18th century, the English and French influence was greater than any other powers. As sectors of trade and territory started converging, it planted seeds of conflict, which some way mirrored the political and military battle in Europe. This geopolitical rivalry, combined with local politico-military issues in the Deccan and in the Coromandel Culling Coast, led to a maze of military action on land and sea, and that results in emerging. So very quickly, as the slide talks, 1725, we see the French establish a port at Mahé on the Malabar coast, and by 1739, Karaikal. Now, Chandernagar was revived with the French government taking active participation. Now, very interestingly, till then, some of the challenges don't take place. The English East India Company saw its influence enhanced, and there was a 15% surge in imports, primarily from India, sourced by the company. In fact, the continuation of the license of the British East India Company was opposed in Parliament in 1730. On the other side, between 1720 and 1740s, French East India Company's trade with India records a tenfold growth, reaching half the volume for the English East India Company. This is what Malleson mentions in his book. And the stakes became too high to be ignored, and it was stage was set for the neutrality of the previous years to be abandoned. So by 1740, there is on one side, you could say there is relative political tranquility in the Indian subcontinent. To the north, Nader Shah's invasion in 1739 had been a large-scale raid. The Nizam provided general stability in the Deccan. To the west, the Marathas were in dominance. But when the War of Austrian Succession broke out in Europe following Frederick the Great of Prussia's seizure of Silesia in 1740, alluded by Davison as early as 1913, the French and British found themselves in opposing camps in this war. Unlike today, when the continental way of looking or obtaining sea power has already been transformed, where we resolve issues, collaborative approach today has a new upsurge. But the aim of bringing these attention is how sea power and India's maritime structure has been shaped through history. The Atlantic rivalry found a theater of sea power contestation in the Bay of Bengal. So let's quickly look at the trajectory of the Carnatic Wars. The first Carnatic War, 1744 to 1748, mounting tensions had seen the French and British have minor clashes and acrimony in the Carnatic. In parallel with this, in 1744, after the Austrian War, Joseph Duplay, the governor of Pondicherry, tried to seek peace between French and British traders, but conflict was inevitable when Commodore Barnett's squadron arrived to prey on French shipping in 1745, which was countered by the French in June 1746. In the Battle of Nagapattinam, Count Bordenai's squadron drove the British naval forces away from the Indian coast, and along with land forces under the command of Duplay, captured Madras in September 1946. Now, the conflict had not been limited just to the European combatants. Indeed, as primary trading interests, French and the British companies needed Indian military assistance. So both Madras and Pondicherry lay within the province of Anwaruddin, the Nawab of Arcot. And with the outbreak of hostilities, the Nawab allied himself with the British. In this event, unfortunate for him and for of little assistance to Madras, on 21st September 1746, 11 days after the fall of Madras, the Nawab's relieving army was defeated by a force of just about 500 Frenchmen. Despite the capture, so please note, despite the capture of Madras and the defeat of British allies, the laurels of victories did not remain with France. In fact, by November 1746, Duplay had commenced the siege of Pondicherry at Cuddalore. But in April 1748, Boscawen arrives. And even though he had moved against Pondicherry in August 1748, the British lift their siege by October. So the French should have had a complete ascendancy. But by end of 1748, peace prevailed between Britain and France. And the French, in exchange for the French fortress of Louisbourg, captured by the American provincials in 1745, was traded for Madras. So the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle ends the Anglo-French War in Europe, and Madras returns to English. Global politics remains intertwined. Very briefly, the Second Carnatic War, this saw more indigenous forces coming to the aid of Europeans and revival of the English conflict. You found Hyderabad and Carnatic succession battles with the French supporting Nasir Jung and English with Muzaffar. And there was a near victory of the French, but it was upstaged when Clive attacks Arcot and Chanda Sahib is killed and a British nominee is placed on the throne of Arcot. Dupley was, of course, replaced by Godoyu and he's used for peace with British. So there's very little, there's no naval component, but just for continuity, I'm just mentioning. Third Carnatic War. The third and final phase of the English-French war for supremacy was precipitated by the 7 years war in Europe. This resulted in the conflict extending to the Indian territories or in the Bay of Bengal. It was compounded by continuing succession battles in Hyderabad and Karnataka. Now, the major occurrence in the war was, of course, an attack on Qasim Bazar in Bengal in 1756 by Siraj ud-Daulah, followed by Clive's attack on Chandernagar. Now, I am not going to go into Battle of Plassey. It's sufficiently rehearsed. But you look at the whole balance of forces, the French support, and at the end, beyond that, go to 1757 and go beyond, French lines of communication for Pondicherry are cut off after the English attack on Karaikal. And by January 6, 1761, surrounded by land, cut off from Fussy, the French surrender. I have one more portion in the naval action to complete, which again gets very, very neglected. And these were the final set of battles in 1780 to 83 between Suffren and Hughes, which Captain A.T. Mahan has dedicated a significant number of pages, including these plates. I'll just capture some brief details. You know, by 1780, Hyder Ali was targeting Madras from landward. January 1781 sees a French squadron decline. In fact, the French squadron refused Hyder Ali's appeal to attack Cuddalore. February 1782, French lose 6 ships post Suffren's attack. April 1782, the French had more engagements in a classic line battle. In fact, the French win the battle, but they have higher casualties. July 1782, the French superiority in the battle is dissipated when status quo is resumed after action is terminated. In April 1783, the French blockade happens as the English fleet now retreats to Madras, but peace is declared between Bussy and Hughes in 1783, and the final chance for French to get any supremacy, and that's why Panikkar talks of 1784, the singularity of maritime control passes on to the hands of the British. Now, let's look at some of the lessons, both in terms of Panikkar's writings and some of the work as my studies on IR theories. So when we analyze the 18th century Bay battles from a perspective of power transition theory, we can examine the effect of maritime dominance over the Indian subcontinent. K.M. Panikkar explains how naval strategy applied by the British in the context of sea power had greater influence in shaping India's maritime strategy. And that's why I'm saying the management of sea power or the evolution of sea power has a role in shaping the values or the directions of nation. The right balance of sea power, sound tactics and strategy leaves a lasting influence in the Anglo-French 18th century battles. So one can see a distinctive offensive realism theory perspective to analyze British naval power in addition to the power transition theory application. So the basic assumption is ascending great powers guarantee their security to build up their forces for deterrence. The real effect of a sound navy or a military is to deter war. The British Navy, through the Anglo-French battles, looked for opportunities to get hegemony in the Indian subcontinent and deter or exclude other powers from the region, and that comes. So, how is it changing today? How is the, what is the Indian construct? Now, Sardar Panikkar did stress highly on the role of India as an emerging sea power in the Indian Ocean region. This quote has been shared a number of times, so I'll probably leave it to be read. But sea power is a larger concept than land power or air power. neither of which encompasses the completeness of geoeconomic dimensions of human activity. And I'm very glad that not just me, but two papers in the next section talk about geoeconomics from existing researchers at MHS and former researchers. So we're very happy to be a very collaborative part. You know, the size of the Navy is not just determined by the threat, but the quantum of maritime assets and interests that you have to safeguard. This is what Jeffrey Till talks about. So sea power is a tight and inseparable system of the Navy with maritime assets, ports, infrastructure, shipping, and many lessons, particularly of the 18th century, have lasting impact in our construct. Now, prior to independence, the primary mission of the Brown Water Royal Indian Navy, only context to the previous speaker, Indian Navy has never thought of coastal defense. We have always thought of a holistic concept. But the direction of the experience of the Indian naval pioneers in the World War and beyond enabled them to envisage what Sardar Panikkar talks about, India as the emerging sea power. Now, historically, Indian subcontinent witnessed the rise of foreign military powers, and Jeffrey Till in his book, Sea Power, A Guide for 21st Century, talks of this changing dynamics, the conventional battle for mastery and the newer concept of battle for maritime security. So requirements, he talks about the need for good order at sea is the primary driver, which enables me to enhance my maritime awareness, which guides the development of maritime policy and leads to an integrated maritime governance. And allow me to anchor that in what we are doing today. Sea power in the 18th century bay battles was needed. It needed the structure of maritime policy to maintain good order at sea. The lesson that we have drawn is Indian Navy's operational tempo has taken a similar strategic shape. And we have arrived as a prominent role and an active stakeholder in the maritime domain. And so when the Prime Minister mentions Sagar, security and growth for all in the region, I'm going to bring it down to the last century and the last year and this year. The last year was a year of the virus, and when Indians had to be brought back, Operation Samudra Setu saw the Indian Navy span across the Indian Ocean and enable the return. 2021 is the year of the vaccine, and Indian Navy's P-8I aircraft provide COVID-19 vaccines across the Indian Ocean. So that is the growth of a collaborative maritime competence where we are taking our rightful place in this construct. As I draw towards this art, last year in maintaining good order at sea, we saw the unfortunate incidents of the oil spill of Mauritius, and Indian Navy deploys Nirikshak for disaster resistance, coming again as a preferred collaborative security partner and as a first responder. My last component before I do my conclusion. Tracing the presence of maritime awareness in the 18th century bay battles required a great maritime awareness. Today, the official term is maritime domain awareness. What has India done? Indian Navy has grown in size and capabilities, and it is a genuine blue water navy in South Asia. As our modernization has persisted, our increased involvement in maritime domain awareness with technological assistance has spanned across the Indian Ocean region. And therefore, in December 2018, Indian Navy launched the Information Fusion Center in collaboration with Information Management and Analysis Center, jointly administered by Indian Navy and other stakeholders, getting information on white shipping and the sectors, Gulf of Guinea, Gulf of Aden, Arabian Sea, Bay of Bengal, South Asia, we span across. And so we have signed agreements with 22 countries and facilitate 30 others to have a virtual network, positively influencing events and easing impact of components. My question is this not Indian maritime consciousness growth, where it is built on both academic and scholarship work? It is there in policy. It is there in operations. It is there in geopolitical construct. There is a increasing recognition and presence of Indian maritime influence across the Indian Ocean and beyond like never before. In conclusion, what shapes the nation today in 21st century. The security, prosperity, and vital interest of India are coupled along with other nations. Our nation's interest can best be served by a peaceful global system of interdependent networks of trade, finance, information, law, people, and governance. Major powers, regional conflict, terrorism, lawlessness, and natural disasters have the potential to threaten our maritime security and world peace and good order. Oceans connect the nations of the world, even the countries that are landlocked. Because the maritime domain supports 90% of world's trade, it carries the lifeblood of a global system that licks every country on earth. Today, India and its partners find themselves competing for a global influence in an era which they are unlikely to be fully at war or fully at peace. And our challenge is to apply sea power in a manner that protects India's interest through greater collective security, stability, and trust. There is a tension between the requirements for peacetime engagement and maintaining proficiency in the skills for 21st century sea power. Maritime forces will contribute to winning wars decisively, but more than to prevent war and win the long struggle against asymmetric challenges. India has always deployed its maritime force to build confidence and trust among nations through collective security efforts. And in continuing to do so, we will require an unprecedented level of integration among our maritime forces and enhanced cooperation with other instruments of national power and international partners. Sea power will be a unifying force for a better tomorrow. And I close with our tagline, Virasat Jagai Samudri Chetna. Let heritage awaken our maritime consciousness. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Commodore Johnson, to end on that very positive note and to expand the definition of sea power, as you've rightly done. And of course, personally for me, that you did draw in heritage and the importance of heritage. So we will, it's sort of proceeding very nicely from the previous paper to yours. And then let's move on to the next speaker, who is Dr. Rohan. Dr. Rohan is Assistant Professor, Department of History, Maitreyi College, University of Delhi. And he will talk about maritime consciousness and the ships of discovery, Atlantic dominance of the Indian Ocean. 15th to 17th century. Dr. Rohan.
Yes, ma'am. I hope I am audible and...
Yes, you are. Yeah.
I'm just sharing my PPT.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
I hope my PPT is also visible to everybody.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Chairperson Professor Ray. And also because since you have been my teacher, you have taught us to fall in love with this particular dimension of history, which is beyond the Gangetic Plains. So thank you for that. And with that, I will start my paper. We'll begin with it. Since all the papers, mostly they have been talking about the poetics of maritime consciousness, my paper is basically going to talk about the grammar of the maritime consciousness. And particularly, I would be focusing on how this maritime consciousness that actually began from the Iberian Peninsula shaped it all. So to give you a brief outline of my paper, I would be defining what age of discovery exactly is. And then I would be talking about in this, that how the three most important things came together to collaborate and help the Portuguese reach India. So first is the very structure of the church and the state that existed at that point of time, and which later on also changed, as in like the whole idea of the seigneurial relations, the feudal relations changed because of the coming of the Crusades, new trade routes began to open. And suddenly, subsequently, the idea of the end of Europe transformed into gateway to the Orient. And the one ocean, one empire concept began to grow further and furthermore. And then I will talk about how the whole system, as I said, seigneurial relation began to change, wherein the Iberian Peninsula, particularly the Portugal royal system and the policy began to assimilate those merchant communities into their own territory that would help grow Portugal as a sea power and becoming a seaborne empire. Then I would be talking about Prince Henry and his school of Sagres. And as my paper, as I said, it is basically on the grammar of how things happen. So the ship of discovery actually has two important components. One is the navigational nautical technology, and the other one is the timber. So the timber that was used for shipping, the kind of scientific forestry that evolved there. And then I would be talking about the marine archaeology and the findings that has actually shaped us in our understanding of that maritime consciousness and its effect on the Indian maritime endeavor also. So to begin with, before the seaborne empire, as in like before the Portuguese seaborne empire came into prominence, we have to understand that it was a feudal system. It was a feudal world, a feudal European system, where Europe was considered mostly as the end of the world. Basically because there was no such relation outside, thought of outside the landmass. So basically, if you see the shipping and the navigation happened, the Vikings, the Venetians, the Phoenicians, the Greeks, everybody did that. But Portugal as such was mostly a pastoralist economy. And if you look at the Portuguese coastal line, it has a scarce islands, and it has not, it has very even less good harbors. There are no gulfs, and the westward winds brings storms more and quite often. So such conditions did not actually help in the beginning to develop a to develop what we refer to as a maritime community in the beginning. And that we see that even in the 13th century documents, we do not have finding, we do not have mention of any fishing or fishing boat or a fishing community in Portugal. But how did it all change? So the question is, how was the Iberian seafaring small nation of a million inhabitants that did not even own the skill to ply the waters as effectively as Vikings or Venetians launched the first campaign and came all the way to the Indian Ocean? So to understand that, we have to understand that there were actually maritime communities, and Panikkar, K.M. Panikkar in his book actually refers to it. And I think he has actually been one of those historians, as Professor Ray actually talked about yesterday, Panikkar as a historian. He actually talks about how the merchants, particularly in that part of the globe, were interested in privateering enterprises. And there are three most important examples of it. So to quote Panikkar in the beginning, he says that the full significance of Da Gama's arrival at Calicut can be recognized only if we appreciate that it was a realization of 200-year-old dream and of 75 years of sustained efforts. So basically, he was talking about the kind of work which was already done before. So I have put here three seals to explain you how the towns that developed around that region were basically celebrating their mercantile enterprise. For example, Lübeck town seal has a ship, so has Danzig, and so has Stralsund. And all these three would in later decades would come and join with the Portuguese. And that would become the very major force to create a maritime hierarchy. Now coming at the foundation of the Portuguese Atlantic dominance itself. So it can be, it's like a pyramidical structure where the foundation was led by the Sagres school and the forest that actually brought timber for the making of the ships. And second comes the Companhia and the Commander system. And the third at the top is the church and the crown. So the church and crown here, as we have to understand that it's a time of crusades. So the church and the crown here are working hand in glove with each other. The idea is to reconquest the Holy Land. And so therefore we would see in the subsequent year, and by 1494, they have a treaty. And that is how the system of padroado or the patronage begins to take shape, where the church divides the whole of the globe into two halves, One is given to Spain and the other to the Portugal. And that is the reason why Portugal, since Indian Ocean lied in their sphere, had to come here. And so the second most important thing we see in Portugal is the changing of the community and the seigneurial relations. How did it change? It is only because that it was a royal policy that it will allow the skillful community to come and settle in Portugal. And that is how it began. So the letter of privileges for merchants were issued. For example, Bardi Company of Florence was issued a letter of privilege in 1338. Milan and Genoese were invited in 1357, Catalan in 1362, and English in 1398. So the merchants were serving as commanders. They were serving as nobles. For example, the commander of the Royal Navy was basically a Genoese merchant. And you see, that is how the whole system of Campania developed further. Now, what is tractators and commendators? So these commendators were basically rural lords who were investing, and the tractators were the agents of trade. So it was a very cohesive relationship where the profit were co-shared as well as the issue. For example, if there is a shipwreck or if there is a kind of a loss in the business, would be taken completely by the crown and the commendators themselves. So that gives some kind of an advantage to the to these agents to be working freely and further on expanding on the horizons of their explorations. And the foundation was obviously Prince Henry the Navigator, who starts the first school of navigation, and where cartography and shipbuilders and travelers from across the globe actually comes and become part of it. Why I'm calling it a globe? Because at that point of time, the understanding of globe was very Eurocentric. So to see a place where you can find a Venetian, a Genoese, even a Jew and an Arab together working was the school of Sagres. So everybody came here. And so at the same time, before that, the state had already put the forest law in 1209, where the forest was the property of the state. And there was many rules and regulations in how one can cut the wood, because we can understand we are talking about a time period where the fuel for cooking is also firewood. So the wood would be used for fuel. So firewood was a very important component of their life. So it has also to be taken care of. So you see that the forest of Liria and Madeira, they were converted into planting oak, that is Cuirass Sivé, which is going to become the main timber for building the ships. As I was mentioning about Padroado patronage, it actually began the whole shaping of Portugal becoming the sword of the Holy See started from the time period of Alfonso in 1179, when Pope Alexander III actually made him the king of Portugal. And that is how it all began. So you see, it's a very fascinating aspect. At one place, they are the sword of the papacy. And on the other hand, they are in commercial transactions. Now, these commercial transactions are not royal royal centric or royal commissioned. They are basically privateers. So at one point of time where Florence and Venice and Bruges, they are facing the brunt at the hands of the Moorish forces because of the Crusades, Lisbon is profiteering from the business in the Maghreb. So they are coming to the regions of Morocco. They are trading. Mining has also began. They are also taking bullion from that particular region. So things have actually evolved, which actually led to the rise of wealth and a growth of a middle class of merchants and craftsmen across Europe. So the wave begins from Portugal, it goes to Spain also, obviously it's an Iberian Peninsula, and it moves further and further more to Italy and to France. Just to give you a fact here, though it's a long thread, when the British came to India and they were looking for silviculturists to take care of the forest, the first of the silviculturists and the forest conservationists came from Germany and France, only because it is that particular region of the world where scientific forestry was taken very seriously at that point in time. And that is the reason why they were invited then. So coming back to the discussion here. So the Portuguese system was different from the rest of the cities. Why? Because merchants were given special treatment. Back in the days of Alfonso III itself, the court fixed the prices for various services of the craftsmen as well as the merchants, and also ensured that their payment is made on time. So basically the whole system of kingship was around the church, and also leveraging commercial transactions further and furthermore. The second most important component is obviously Prince Henry and the School of Sagres, and the very idea of celebrating their commercial enterprise. By as you can see down there, there is a painting where the Caraval is painting and painted, and it comes from 1485. Though it is 25 years after the death of Henry, the painting, but you can understand the kind of work that was done at that point of time in Sagres only by understanding the fact that this particular school of Sagres had every important people who you can think of at that point of time. So the Venetians and Genoese were already there, the Jews were already there, the Arabs were there. Niccolo Conti was an important part of the school of Sagres, the only person who had actually seen the interiors and the hinterland of India. So as you can see, different conflicting forces were brought into this school. For example, Jews who were considered to be a sinful people because they were as a Catholic, as if you're a good Catholic, you cannot be indulging in usury, where Jews were. So that was a conflicting communities together. Arabs too, who were already part of the Crusades. There were many people from Arab who were actually part here. For example, the map of illiteracy came all the way to School of Sagres, which became the foundation on which Mappa Mondorum would be further on based and would be created. And that would be the map with which Vasco da Gama would come to India. For example, James Kreskis, I just mentioned the name here, of the geographer who made the Mappa Mondorum, Patricio Conti, Columbus, Pedro Cabral, Duarte Pavesi, and Castro, all of these people were part of this particular team. And this is how the School of Sagres actually laid the foundation of what we can say of the seaborne empire, which was going to take shape, and the discovery that was going to happen in the coming decades. Now, Prince Henry, apart from all this, was also responsible for breaking that psychological barrier. Now, normally, in the in Iberian Peninsula, the understanding was that the once you reach Cape Bojador, you actually reach a region which they termed as Sea of Terror. Particularly, the Spanish mariners called that particular place Sea of Terror because they thought that there are no trees grow, there are no landforms, and there is no human inhabitation. But Henry, through smaller campaigns, through smaller voyages, through smaller explorations, began to send his own clerks and certain people who were already trained as captains, and waited patiently until they themselves break that psychological barrier. And that happened by 1436, when one of the captains actually traveled 338 kilometers, that is 70 leagues beyond that cape. And now they were very happy that at least they are, whatever the imaginations they have of the land beyond a particular point, because they could not go for longer voyages by that time, can be achievable. So the conceivability of the maritime expanse and the idea that they can tame it actually came together. And it was a process for which I think Sagres School actually should be appreciated, the way they have actually worked. By 1441, the small barrenders, it was kind of smaller boats, were replaced by longer and sturdier caravela and naveta, a small boat with provisions for months for sailors. Now, after all, the shipbuilders had to also complement the pace of the fearless and more confident marine endeavors. And this is the map that I have put in here, just to tell you that by 1494, the church actually had divided the whole of the globe into two. There you can see a line, and I've drawn a circle so that you can understand that the west of that line belonged to Spain and the east of that line belonged to Portugal. And that is how they divided it. And so therefore, the Portuguese had had the complete monopoly over coming to India and planning it thereof. Now, timber for ship. How the ships were made is important and has to be understood. And this is where the consciousness plays a major role. There is a Greek sage, Anakarsi Saithya, he says, the salvation of seafarers lies in the single plank, in a single plank, and only two fingers of its thickness exist between them and death. And as I have already mentioned, timber was made the property of the state. King Denys, in his Rennilius, by law had converted the pine forest of Lyra specifically for planting oak for shipbuilding purposes, and later was added Madeira. Oak was that was for good for shipbuilding, was also good for firewood, as I told you that it was a very important part of their life, so they could not do without it. The two pictures that you can see is the way they have actually taken out the bark and to make the cork and to take the firewood. So, however, rather than impeding the process, it bolstered the quality of timber in return. So, if you take the firewood, if you take the bark out and you just take it, it would actually enhance the quality of the timber. And this is a learning that they already had with the kind of experimentations that they did for almost 60 to 65 years. Now, regular pruning of oak provided for firewood, while in the process, the density of the heartwood would increase by 15%, making the wood even more suitable for building ships. Now, it would make it more resinous, so it would be not susceptible to the wood, to the sea worm and other things. This paved the way for scientific forestry in Iberian Peninsula. Both oak and ash were planted for shipbuilding, while the former was grown bent or crooked for getting better shapes for ships. The latter was grown straight so that each grain and tissue run continuously straight without cutting through in the workmanship. So gradually several timber varieties of oak, because oak at one point of time, because if you keep on cutting the trees, you need time to regrow them. So you have to also focus on other varieties. So ash, elm, sycamore and larch, spruce, silver fir, they all were scientifically grown in a grouping system. The plantation owners were given subsidies to grow oak within a certain distance from Spain in the 15th century as well. Now you see that the monopoly of the state of the timber forest was already there with the state, so they came up with many laws. For example, they had they made coppicing, that is cutting the oak tree at foot, punishable by 1546, and it was done later. But as you can understand that in the beginning they had different other ways to look at it. To give you an understanding of how much you require the oak or the trees, you have to understand this graph. Imagine that there is only one ship that the Portuguese have. To sustain one ship, a ship can only live for 12 years. That is the average lifespan expectancy of a vessel. So for 12 years, you actually require 4,000 trees. Now, if you calculate it for 150 years, it comes out to be 40,000 trees. So if you have one vessel to take care of and that can only survive for 12 years, you have to ensure the supply of 40,000 trees, and I'm not including here the kind of replacement the timber would require. Also, to grow 22 oak trees, you need 1 acre of forest. That is 182 acres for 4,000 trees. So you need a very bigger space for forest, and you need to control it also. So you have to ensure security. You have to give the kind of benefits to the people who are growing it. And so therefore, two important places were there from where the timbers were actually brought. One was the pine forest of Lyra, which I have actually mentioned, and Madeira also. As you can see the location, Madeira is far away from the coastal line. There's the red structure that you can see, and I have elongated it for your understanding. And then you can see that pine forest of Lyra was already there in the Iberian Peninsula, very close to Lisbon. So it actually gave you timber at this point of time, and particularly oak and ash. As I said, at the coast, you see there's a painting which actually describes how the shipbuilding industry and also developed around the port towns, and it actually became a very lucrative business for many, many people, and that is how they indulged in it. So, in other words, maritime presence, shipbuilding as an industry was a very important part of their historical paraphernalia. Everything was actually made so important that it could not be taken away from. For example, look at the ship of discovery, the kind of details that they have given us. Saint Gabriel, that I have given you the details of, was designed by Captain De Silva, and it is that ship which Vasco da Gama took to India. Now, the exact measurements are available to us, and it is available to us by Alvaro Velho's diary, who was actually traveling on another ship which was under the commandership of Vasco da Gama's brother, because as we know from our history itself that there were four different vessels that came to India. So it was basically a nau which was there, and the crew comprised of 160 members. So Saint Gabriel, Saint Rafael, the other was a Biero, which was actually Saint Miguel, and a 200-ton carrier ship, which was under the command of Nunez. Now you have to understand, while making these ships, there was an understanding. The understanding is very clear. Number one, that they do not know how far is India. So they have to build a ship which is bigger enough to keep the provisions, but smaller enough to maneuver through the bays if they find any bays. So therefore, the kind of understanding they had while making the ship also tells you a lot about how they planned it. And this is how they also had architects for the shipbuilding, which were also silviculturists in a sense. Why I say that? Because Lavana gives you an important detail. For example, he mentions a very intricate difference between the Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean. He says that, number one, Atlantic Ocean is colder than the Indian Ocean. So Indian Ocean is warmer waters. So first of all, your keel, whatever the structure that you're going to make, you cannot make it very shallow, because if you do it, there's a possibility that it can break, because they have also got the reference from Ibn Battuta, because Ibn Battuta in his writing says that once you are closer to the ports, it is not that shallow, and there is a possibility that your whole hull will break. So such kind of understanding they already have, and therefore they purposely chose to use iron nails in their ships, only because if they would have used wooden nails, it would have destroyed the whole ship, because it is susceptible to woodworms, sea worms. For example, there are two different techniques which they already used before. For example, they used torno and sovina to tie those long logs. But at this point of time, they had shifted to iron nails. So such kind of changes were brought in. And all these details, fascinating details, and the number of people that came to India. For example, by one of the data that is given, and that was saved until 1755, when there was an earthquake and the whole library was destroyed, the data that was available until then was there were 80,000 men who traveled to India from 1497 to 1527 in 320 ships, on an average of 250 crew members per ship. So such kind of a detailed account is only seen at that point in time. The shipbuilding called for a shipyard across the regions. As I told you that oak, you need timber for the sustenance of such a big empire. So oak and ash could not meet their growing demand. So they had to open three more factories. One was obviously at Oporto and Lisbon, two more in Goa and Cochin. Now you understand why and how these particular positions were taken. To understand, you have to also understand the conscious effort that the Portuguese took in looking at the topography and the geographical regions that they are going to set the factory at. For example, Calicut was closer to the Nilambar forest, which was connected with river Bipur. This river Bipur has two tributaries. One originates from Nilgiri, the other one originates from Wayanad. And then it further joins Kalai River, and then it further, this river Bipur cuts Zamorin, the kingdom of Zamorin, into two equal halves, and then it actually drains into Arabian Sea. So by setting a factory at Bayapur, they could have controlled this whole Nelambar forest, as well as they could have got timber from the Kadalundi forest region. So the teak, the Malabar teak that we know of, actually was a very important region why they established a factory there. So goes for another linkages, which is in Cochin, Ponai River, and the connection with the Periyar and the Chalakudi River, which actually has two lakes, Kraganur and the Webanadu Lake. That also was one of the routes through which, navigable routes, through which they could have brought timber. And the third was obviously the region between Goa and Chol, the two important ports, where the timber was brought from Besan, and a place called Balghat, that was then a part of the Bijapur kingdom. So as you can see, that by taking control of the teak of India, the Malabar teak, they also expanded the average life of a ship, which actually increased from 12 years to 35 years. And that is why they preferred more Malabar teak over the oak in the subsequent years. Now, on the left, you have the painting of the ship which Columbus took, painted in 1493. And on the right, you have the reconstruction of that now, which Vasco da Gama may have taken. So this is a reconstruction. This is a very recent reconstruction done at the university at Texas. Now, there were mentioned 167 varieties of ships. I could not list all. I have put only 15. But as you can see, on the origins, you would see that most of them are Indian, and those that are made and are of European origin, they have guns. For example, if you look at now, that is Karak, they have cannons on this, and this is basically the ship of discovery. Apart from the barrels and the galleons that the previous speakers were talking about, all these details have been very fascinatingly put in order to give you an understanding that they have varieties of ship, which actually makes me to go ahead and argue that the Portuguese not only had bigger ships, they have a good understanding of the bays in India, and therefore they could also maneuver with smaller ships, and that is how they had a long fleet or a bigger fleet than most of the Indian kingdoms. Because in India, as Professor Ray has already talked at many places about it, that the focus was always on land. So the very conceivability of the importance of ship and the ocean was always denied and never looked at. So therefore, if you look at the kind of understanding the Portuguese had, the kind of documentation that they kept, also tells you about how conscious were they about the importance of it. And when I say consciousness, I also say that they are not only confident about their superiority, they are also very conscious of their failures. They are learning from their failures. For example, when Lavana comes to India, he gets time, he takes time Lavana never comes to India, I'm sorry, but he gets the time to read and to get the book of King Bhoj, and who actually wrote Yukti Kalapatru, where he talks about Niloham method. What is this Niloham method? It's a very simple method. In India, you would see that they would use threads, swing together by coir threads to contain those ship logs. But in here, it is Lavana who says that we cannot do it because it is warmer seas, and therefore we have to go on to the iron nails. Also, he says, by looking at the comparison, he says that the timber is lighter, 1/4 lighter than the oak that is found in Portugal. So it is important for us that whenever we make the ship, we also put iron masts and also a cabin, an elevated cabin which does not give a lot of pressure on the hull, so that the cannon could be put. So the whole architectural dimension of the ship depended also a lot on the timber and the variety of timber that they used. For example, to build the flat keel and the backbone that we know of, they always used more resinous varieties of timber. Whereas while making the heel, which we will see in the other picture, was made of oak because that was resinous and it would cut across, because it was heavier, it would cut across the oceans. And if there is some problem, it would not break the ship. So such kind of an understanding happened. Now, how collectively conscious the Portuguese happened to be, one can understand that in 1960s, they celebrated the 500th anniversary of Prince Henry. And with that, they also initiated many maritime and nautical archaeological studies, particularly in the University of Lisbon and the Texas A&M. So many projects of exploration began to take shape. And until now, they have explored 37 bigger shipwrecks. One of the most fascinating ones and the most successful ones is Project Paperwreck. I would hopefully show you a picture of that also. So you see that methods of research, which is later developments, for example, dendroarchaeology and dendrology, helps us to understand today that what kind of ships and the timbers that they used. But you look at the understanding of the ecology and the forestry that was already there in picture, though it could be considered rudimentary in certain aspects because they were not prepared for it. They did not have modern scientific tools. But yes, they had a very important place given to the environment and ecology and the forest in making what Portuguese came to be later on. In your screen, as you can see, there's a heel, the one which has been painted, sketched by Lavana in the 17th century treatise. He gives you a design of the heel. And on the right, you would see that a similar heel has been found, which is which actually gives you a date also through carbon dating, that it is a 15th century shipwreck. It is of Rio de Aveiro, and it's a very important caravela, which was actually found very close to the Atlantic Ocean, very close to the port of Lisbon. So again, another image, it is from Project Paperwreck. As you can see, you have a cannon that you can see, which was found. It is a cannon, it's a bronze cannon that was found in the shipwreck. And on the right, you see the 3D model, which was created by three scholars, Reed, Hilloth, and Juan, where they actually give you an understanding that how things, how the ship would have looked like once it was constructed. So such kind of activities, such kind of studies has also given us a very important understanding of what has happened. Now, coming to India.
Sorry, Dr. Rohanad, I'm so sorry to interrupt, but I think you'll need to wind up.
Ma'am, it's my last slide. I'm just getting
ready. Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. If you look at India also, the marine archaeology is now in the last two decades, they are also developing in India. Particularly, we have found five shipwrecks. One is at Suchi Reef, as you can see. The other one is George Reef, Amisols, Sail Rock, and Rock Islands at the Goa coast. Minicoy, we have also find at Lakshadweep, and two other on the other side, that is on the Coromandel. One is the Odisha and the Tamil Nadu. So it's not like that we have not began the process of finding and discovering new things, adding to our own sources and resources in order to understand that what kind of ships traveled and voyaged in that particular route. But we also have an understanding of this fascinating consciousness that has been developing, where we have to move outside the land premise, rather than looking at the agrarian relations only, we also have to look at the oceanic relations. And that is what I think Panikkar was trying to highlight when he was trying to talk about the dominance, the presence of India in the Indian Oceanic Zone. And I think the last slide, which I want to show, that see how the timber is been celebrated. What you see is a very later picture. It is from Britain. It is actually celebrating Britain's glory and protection. What you see is the naval ships in the background, and Britannia is holding an oak seedling in her hands. Now that was the symbol of the British strength in the maritime, as a maritime nation. So as you can see, it was well conceived then, and that is the reason why they could colonize, from moving from mercantilism to financial capitalism and taking care of taking hold of India with them. And I think with this, I will close it. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. And both for a fascinating lecture, your slides were very well chosen. I thoroughly enjoyed the lecture. And more importantly, I think for me, you've expanded the discussion into timber, varieties of timber, navigation. But more importantly, you brought into discussion research, not just research by the Portuguese, but research by the descendants of the Portuguese who today celebrate maritime consciousness. And, you sounded on a very positive note, maybe because of my age. I feel very despondent even today, we are at a sort of primitive stage of creating this love for the sea. And we really have a long way to go. But thank you very much for that talk. And we'll come back to it in the discussion. May I now call upon Dr. Krishnendra Meena. He's an associate professor. He's at the at CPOT in the Jawaharlal Nehru University in the School of International Relations. He's a teacher there and is also the Secretary General, if I'm not mistaken, of the Society for Indian Ocean Studies. So welcome, Dr. Meena, and we look forward to your presentation, which is on the British Imperial Vision of the Indian Ocean, with reference to the works of Sir Halford J. Mackinder. So over to you.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks a lot. Let me, at the beginning, say extend my thanks to ICWA and for organizing this wonderful, excellent conference on one of the leading strategic thinkers that India has produced, and also to Dr. Pragya Pandey for generously inviting me to this conference. My paper perhaps may not be directly related to K.M. Panikkar's work, but it is has a linkage in the sense that both the scholars, Halford J. Mackinder, who has been considered as a land power theorist in larger understanding of geopolitics and geostrategy, has borrowed a lot from Mahan. And similarly, Sardar K.M. Panikkar has also learned a lot from Mahan, so much so that the title of his very important book is influenced by the title of Mahan's very important book. My interest in the field is because of very simple reasons that I teach political geography and geopolitics at JNU. Plus, I have done my PhD on a similar topic, which is about British geopolitics in the South Atlantic. And it also, so that during that reading, during the readings for my PhD, I have stumbled upon the fact that even before Halford J. Mackinder, who is known for his work on heartland and the geographical pivots of history, when he writes this, he was already aware of the ideas of Mahan, like the command of the sea and sea power. So that is what he expands on the land power, and while arguing that land power is the most important way to basically become dominant in the world. But at the back of his mind, he has this feeling, and he has this vulnerability about the British situation if the United States or the Russians become very powerful, or if the Russians and the Germans combine, what will happen to the primacy of the UK? That is the kind of anxieties that Mackinder has, which bring him to this. And then for that, he reads Mahan thoroughly. So what I will do is that I have done a reading of his two important works. One which, and they are both at the beginning of the 20th century, but they speak about the Atlantic power, that is the British themselves, and their understanding of Atlantic vis-a-vis Europe and the United States, as well as their understanding of the Indian Ocean during the early part of the 20th century. And Mackinder, for his part, was a very influential persona in the context of that. He was an MP. He was a member of parliament in the United Kingdom. He was also the British ambassador to Russia. He founded the London School of Economics. He was one of the founder directors of that. He was also very instrumental in establishing a number of geography departments in universities around the UK, most importantly in Oxford and Cambridge. So in that sense, he was a quite influential in person, and that's why it is important for us to understand the British imperial vision through his works, because he had such an influence in the larger British system. He has been considered as a manpower theorist who devised, so I'll begin this by saying that he's been considered as a land power theorist. He devised the Heartland Theory with his landmark paper, The Geographical Pivot of History, and which he later developed as the Heartland in his next work, Democratic Ideals and Reality, and further expands his map of the Heartland in The Round World and The Winning of Peace, where he accommodated air power after considering its significance during the Second World War. But we find that the amount of literature on his about his work and around his work, Geographical Pivot and Heartland, is monumental. But what it also does is that it basically observes Mackinder's work about the sea, which brought him to this understanding of land power to a background. So it brings all these ideas about his understanding of the sea to the background. It does not help that he had this brilliant understanding of the sea to arrive at this understanding of Heartland. So my task here in this paper is to put Mackinder's understanding of sea power and command of the sea, both Mahanian ideas, in perspective, and to make clear that Mackinder had clearly read Admiral Mahan's work on sea power, and he was totally aware of his prowess as a naval historian. And the explanations which Mahan did for British dominance in the sea for the previous 200 years, through his reading, Mahan's naval history of Britain, was very, very widely taken up and widely understood in the British circle. And it was a very, he was a celebrated author in that sense. He was awarded honorary doctorates in Britain by both Oxford and Cambridge. And so my task here is to highlight that what did Mackinder borrow from Mahan. As we know that Sardar Panikkar also was influenced by the works of Mahan. So I'll discuss each of these two books. First is the Britain and the British Seas, which was published in 1902, and for which he was the sole author. So it is in the beginning of the book, one of the later chapters, when he speaks about the imperial seas of Britain, he says the defense of Britain rests fundamentally upon the theory implied in the command of the sea, which means he was appreciative of the command of the sea arrived at by Mahan. And in this expression, he says, is not meant to convey any claim of sovereignty on the high seas, but it is, one must clearly understand that a power has the command of the sea as against another power which it is at war, when it has destroyed the enemy's fleet or securely blockaded it. And thus, power takes the national frontier further towards the enemy's force. So that was one aspect which he takes from Mahan. And very interestingly, one of the six characteristics of Mahanian sea power is very clearly visible in his work. He says that it is clear, and I quote, "It is clear that under such circumstances, England would be safe from invasion by sea, and France would be liable to it. Hence, when they have the command of the sea, it says hence the expression that the navy is Britain's shield and the army her spear. The enemy's coasts are the utmost limit of sea power, whose final office is to give freedom in the selection of the point at which to deliver an attack with land force." So that is directly from one of the six characteristics from Mahan sea power, when he talks about the coastline of a particular state. He says further that Britain has three problems related to the sea. One is the retention of the command of the sea. Second is the defense of the Great Britain should the command of the sea be temporarily lost. That is the second problem. The third is that the separate defense of Ireland in the same contingency. So his threefold problems, he says, can be overcome by the development and have been addressed over the years during the last two centuries through the use of a very powerful British Navy. But on the other hand, if you look at the British homeland, there are two regions which are threatened most through sea power of other countries. One of them is the Channel entry, and the other is the metropolis, that is the London and the region around the London and the regions around it. And he says that it is important that the British take care of, in relation to the continental Europe, take care of these two important things by concentrating their forces, as Mahan would have argued, concentrating naval forces around the British coastline. Then he goes on to explain the British coastline and explains the kind, number of ports they have, number of harbors they have, number of naval ships which are positioned at each of these harbors. And then he explains that if the first instance were to happen, that if the British were to lose the command of the sea, these harbors, which are located, are at the remote edge of the land and away from all the great centers of population, and they would become nests of hostile cruisers if invaded from the continental Europe, and they will make a huge impact on the British defenses. Then he turns his attention to the larger Atlantic. He says that and then brings in the Indian angle, to which the British had derived and extracted a huge amount of resources over their over the period of their colonization. He says Britain undertook the conquest of India in the course of trade competition with France. She extended her Indian domain to prevent interference with her rule from without. She became the mistress of Egypt and of the Cape because they command roads to the Indies, that is, towards India. So, a clear awareness about the importance of Suez Canal and its linkage to Indian Ocean. Then he says the Rhodesia and Transvaal, that is, parts of the South Africa, parts of the contemporary South Africa, they said the British have annexed Rhodesia and Transvaal in order to protect her position at the Cape. So, another important route is being covered by their control of the Cape of Good Hope. He says, further, it is important, and this is again very close to what Mahan had said about the command of sea and the control of role of commerce. He says, not wholly dissimilar from annexed territory is the mercantile and naval shipping which flies the British flag on the high sea. The ocean covers three quarters of the globe, and it is a vast neutral territory controlled by international law. Beyond the 3 mile coast, the 3 mile limit of coastal water, and for some purposes even within it, a ship is moving. A ship is a moving island belonging to the state whose flag she bears. So, in that sense, he is saying that the British Navy and its understanding of the international waters and its understanding of the fact that Navy and the mercantile trading of number of companies which were doing trade around the world, plus the commerce which the Britishers could control through the control of these important lanes of communication, was very pivotal to their movement in the sea, and of course to their extraction of resources from India. He says, on account of the cheapness of capital and of coal and iron, this is towards the end of this is about the 19th century. And of coal and iron, Britain has become the chief shipbuilder and ship owner of the world, and nearly half of the excess of imports over exports may be accounted for as the incoming profits of the British carrying trade. So the direct link between shipbuilding and trade is visible in his work. He says a little reference to Mahan, he says that the mere fact of insular position would not suffice to produce this result. This is a reference to Mahan, in my understanding, because Mahan argued that nations with insular positions have a seafaring mercantile attitude. But he says only that was the case with the British, that they have an insular position and which leads to the seafaring attitude. That is not the case. The British had actually invested themselves in shipbuilding. He borrows directly from Mahan while arguing that the command of the sea, the technical naval sense, would be just as necessary for the effective defense of Britain. Were her carrying trade smaller, but her fleet would be more difficult to maintain, for the national income would be less. So this is again a direct reference to command of the sea, direct reference to Mahanian sea power, who says that the sea power is a combination of two factors, that is command of the sea through naval superiority, plus combination of maritime commerce, overseas possessions, and privileged access to foreign markets. And this is what produces national wealth and greed. So there is a direct link with what you wanted to say about the command of the sea, this Mahan's work. Further, he explains that the British Mediterranean fleet acts incidentally for the defense of London on account of two factors. One is that these ships are primarily located for the defense of the road to India, but by securing Mediterranean, they effectively also secure London, because of the presence of Russia and France in both towards the Atlantic. For Russia, it was through the Baltic, and for France, it is through the Atlantic and Mediterranean. We know that Russians had access to the through the Crimean Peninsula at that point towards the Mediterranean, and the French had the Mediterranean coastline. So be aware of that. We argue that it is the British Mediterranean fleet have two functions, that is of controlling the sea lanes of communication towards India, plus defense of the British mainland itself. He says, while maintaining this imperial road, that is through the Mediterranean, running from the Mediterranean towards the Indian Ocean, that subserves also the purpose of the defense of the main British island, and owing to the continuity of the ocean and to the consequent mobility of sea power, the same may be said of every British squadron, whether in the Indian Ocean, at the Cape, in the China Seas, in the Australian Seas, off the Pacific coast of America, in the West Indies, or at the Falkland Islands. So he's basically aware of the importance of both Atlantic and the Indian Ocean, and the connectivity which was afforded to the movement of the British ships around the both in the Atlantic as well as in the Indian Ocean. He says the Indian army which is there in India is of utmost importance to the defense of London, because it is always maintained on a war footing, and it is serves as a school for the training of officers and men who, on their return to Britain, form the reserves for the British forces. And sometimes they are officially recognized, and sometimes they are not, but they basically serve as reserves. So this is what he speaks about in his work on Britain and the British cities, about the linkage between the Atlantic and the Indian Ocean, about the linkage between the Mediterranean with the Arabian Sea through the Suez Canal. And he outlines this picture wherein he says, and that borrows heavily from what Mahan had to say about the command of the sea and maritime commerce. But in his second work, which is also being discussed in this paper here, there are these eight lectures on India, which were prepared on the direction of the Regional Instruction Committee of the Colonial Office, and they were delivered in the British Parliament for the for a better understanding of India for the British parliamentarians. It's the very important part about his understanding of the Indian Ocean is that he begins with a very important and a very powerful sentence. He says that from London to Colombo and Bombay is the naval highest fleet of the British Empire. And at Gibraltar, Malta, and Aden, where the waterway is narrow and enemies might obstruct, are British garrisons and naval stations. To put the same in perspective, he says, Colombo is one of the key centers of communications in the world. Someday, when the dominions beyond the seas have grown to be as rich and as populous as Britain herself, the way through the Mediterranean, today all important, will be reckoned as one of several equal threats of imperial power. One of the other great themes of traffic, he says, India bound will then converge upon Colombo from the Cape in the southwest, from Australia in the southeast, and by way of Singapore from Canada in the east. So that connectivity of the Indian Ocean, and this perhaps can be a prelude or say can be a premonition about this current usage of the term Indo-Pacific, which has again a very dubious history over which we can have a larger discussion. But nonetheless, he is aware of the fact that Indian Ocean connects the Atlantic through two ways, through the Suez Canal and through the Cape of Good Hope. It also connects Australia. It also connects the Pacific through Singapore and from Canada onwards. And it serves them a very important imperial purpose. He outlines further that how Indian Peninsula projects over to the Indian Ocean. It is from Cape Comorin. There are two coasts diverging. The one known as the Malabar Coast, it runs northwestward for 1,000 miles. And the other known as the Coromandel Coast runs northward towards and the northeastward for a like distance. And the surf of Arabian Sea beats on the Malabar Coast and that of the Bay of Bengal on the Coromandel Coast. And he keeps on explaining these things, but it is on his lecture on Myanmar that he explains the economic importance of the the British naval control of the Indian Ocean. He says geographically, though placed Myanmar, though it is placed in the Indo-Chinese Peninsula beyond the Bay of Bengal, but it is in Burma, is in relation with the Indian world, for it has a great navigable river which drains into the Indian Ocean, not into the Pacific. And as do the rivers of Siam and Annam, the remaining countries of the Southeast Promontory of Asia. So it is largely the Southeast Asian part of larger, which is largely more akin to India than to and it has connections and orientation towards Indian Ocean rather than towards the Pacific Ocean. Further explained that while he explains a little bit about his travel from Madras towards Rangoon, and he says it was earlier it was necessary to go out to the vessel through the surf in especially constructed boats, for all the Coromandel Coast is shoal and there is not a single natural harbour. Often the surf is very rough. Now, however, a harbour has been made at Madras. Says the vessel in which he is travelling, at least nearly 2,000 coolies. They are all natives of Madras, going to Burma to work in the rice mills or on the wharf. So Burma is a thinly peopled land. It has a great natural resources which are being rapidly developed by the British capital. So the labor to basically harvest, to extract resources from Burma are being carried from Madras. Or from the Indian Peninsula. But this also signifies that the eastern coast was connected directly to the Burmese mainland, rather than we understanding that Burma is only connected, and that we have all a number of times harked back to this idea that look east and act east can function the best through the landward movement. But it is also important to understand that there have been connections, not only by the earlier period during the Chola Empire, but it is also important that we understand that the Britishers are very appreciative of the fact of the unity of the Indian Ocean, which was arrived at through their own imperial vision, but also through their through the understanding of the previous Indian emperor. He says that there is the link between the Indian mainland and the Indian Empire for the British is visible. The link between Indian Empire if the Chinese is visible as we move further east, because the relations of Burma with Singapore and the regions of the Far East are basically mediated by the relations with the Chinese. And that is also the case in today's context. Burmese rice, he says, is sent to the sent to China, the Malaya states, India, East Africa, and Europe. Rangoon depends for our commerce mainly on the rice harvest. In recent years, famines in India have been mitigated by rice exported from Rangoon. Further, the Burmese king, King Thibaw, when he surrendered to the British generals in 1885, was kept as a kept under civil surveillance on the Malabar coast. And from Burma, he says, we take the steamer again and cross the sea to Bengal, that is the metropolitan province of India. They reach Calcutta from there. Again, he says that from that particular port, from the port of Calcutta, as we enters, their ship enters the harbor, he says that there are a number of outward bound ships who are carrying coolies to South Africa. So again, that linkage of trade linkage plus, one can say that those coolies, the linkage of migration of labor is again there. And most of these coolies are natives of the basin of Ganges or Ganga. And because that basin of Ganga is one of the most densely peopled lands in the world. And it sends forth annually some 1,000 emigrants towards South Africa and other parts of the world.
Excuse me, Dr. Meena, sorry to interrupt. Yes. But if you can please wind up, otherwise we won't have any time for discussion.
Ma'am,
so that would be really nice if you can wind up.
Another 2 minutes.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
Okay. So he then outlines that the British railway system, which was developed over the peninsula, connects these two shores, the eastern coast and the western coast of India, and provides for effective movement of both the troops and the resources which are being extracted from the Indian peninsula and the Indian mainland, plus Indian subcontinent, plus from Burma and east and towards the East Indies. He explains in detail about the importance of Calcutta in the international system, and further on explains the importance of the western coastline of India as well as the eastern coastline of India by outlining that they are now effectively under the British control, apart from two places, where one is the Goa, where the Portuguese government is stronger, and the other, there are smaller territories where the French are stronger. And then later on, he explains the linkages of the sea through Rajputana, as well as the control of the coast of now what is Pakistan now, the control of the port of Karachi, and the dominance of the western and the control of the western part of India through the control of British control of the port of Mumbai or Bombay at that point. So that is largely what I wanted to say. And the large point in my presentation is that a huge amount of attention which is given by Mackinder to the oceanic space is lacking, and it is through this knowledge of and understanding of the oceanic space that he arrives at his theory of heartland. That he argues that there is a deficiency with the British, that is, that they do not have the sufficient amount of land, and perhaps that deficiency is being overcome through the acquisition of a number of colonies around the world. So that is what I have wanted to say. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. And I sincerely apologize both to Dr. Meena and to Dr. Rohan for interrupting and for asking you to wind up. So please do accept my apologies. But I thought we could have some discussion at the end of what has been a fascinating morning. I think if I may be excused because of that. I already have questions. One is by Commodore Srikanth Kesnur. And this is to Ms. Amrita, and I will just read it out. Compliments Amrita ji for bringing out a concept of sea control versus sea defense that you extrapolate from Panikkar, and therefore the need for offensive capabilities at sea. I do not agree with you, though, that continental powers triumphed over maritime powers at all times in history, if that is what you suggested. A wonderful, pertinent talk otherwise. Amrita, would you like to respond to that, please?
Thank you, Kamal or Kesun, for your question. So the point about land versus maritime, who won there? This was Panikkar's analysis. This is not what I said. He was of the opinion that wherever there was a combat, there was a war between a continental power and a maritime power, the continental powers have won. And he has given a few examples. Although now whether this is true or why he said that is not evident in his writings. I would like to, in fact, hear more of about this from someone else. Thank you.
Thanks. The second question is to Dr. Rohan. And this is from Dr. R.M. Nair, and he wants to know if there are books or websites on the shipbuilding ecosystem of Portugal, which you presented very well and in great detail. So could you point out to certain, you know, certain sort of books sources which one can use?
See, the first thing that I think you should look at is the Portuguese museum site. There's one particular website which is particularly for the marine archaeology. And in 2015, every year they have a seminar, they have an international conference of, and all the papers are actually put on the website. So if you go to look at 2015 conference, there were 18 papers presented only on shipwrecks, and every shipwreck was discussed. So that is one. Number two is A&M Texas University NOTARC EDU site. You can go there and have a look at that. And apart from that, you have to go to the institution. There's one institute in Goa where you have a library where you will find certain readings on that. You can also follow certain articles by Sila Tripathi. He has written, he has done a great job. So you can read that. And you can also follow, if you have some time to locate it, for example, you can read Castro's work on shipbuilding and Portuguese. And if I have to give you a list, I will, if I can upload the paper, I can send you the paper also. So you, all you can do is you can put your mail account, and I will surely give you the list of the books that is that are available here, because there are a lot. For example, you can read R.G. Albion. He has actually talked about forest and sea power. That is actually the book from where most of the scholars have taken the idea that how forest has to be seen as a very important force in the whole idea of a seaborne empire. So you can start from there on, and then you can add on to shipwreck and other information from these sites. I think I hope I have answered your question.
Yes, thank you. And I would also like to add that at the previous seminar that we had on here in ICWA last year on maritime, I even forget what it was on, on Project Mawsam, there was Michael Johnson from UAE. And in UAE, they have actually documented all the maritime ship, all the Portuguese shipwrecks that were found in the Gulf and have published that. And I do appreciate, Rohan, you're bringing in shipwrecks and shipbuilding. And I cannot desist from saying that we in India lag far, far behind. We have no Portuguese shipwreck. We have no documentation. So don't even get me started on that, because that's something which I can continue for the whole afternoon. I will stop there. And please request the audience who've been really excellent to ask further questions.
In fact, ma'am, if I can add,
yes.
The whole finding and the marine archaeology is so new, and I think it is less given preference by. For example, in 1962-1967, when the first Indian Oceanic International Expedition happened, they did not even thought about marine archaeology. And then the next second expedition, which has just got over 2015 to 2020, they have given no space for marine archaeology at all, no finding of shipwrecks. So I think it is also, when we talk about maritime consciousness, I think talking about defense and policy is one thing, and creating a sense of history is other. So I think there are very few people here who are working on this. and they should be appreciated. And that is the reason why I mentioned the name of Sheela Tripathi, who has done a commendable job. And there are a few other people, and one amongst them is me also. So we are just trying to...
Wonderful, wonderful. We greatly appreciate that. Thank you, wonderful. May I request more questions? Otherwise, I'm going to ask a question to Commodore Johnson, which really goes back to his last site, where he talked about maritime heritage and maritime consciousness. Now, again, you know, like shipwreck sites and sort of maritime archaeology, which we all hear. Maritime heritage is a much misused term, very little appreciated. And my pet peeve is we did nothing with that Project Mawsome, which we could have developed much better. Could I request you to react to the statement that really maritime heritage is much maligned and not what it really should be?
Thank you, Professor. And I think we've been having some of these conversations for a few years. Yes. But past apart, in beyond the technicalities of what is history, what is heritage, and I'm not going to go into that. Let's talk of heritage in the maritime domain. You are right. There is an absence of focused research, focused fresh scholarship on certain sectors which are absolutely vital. That is a fact, and we can bemoan it, and we can stress the need of its refocus. So let's talk about what some of the things have happened, just say in this pandemic period in the last 1 year. Let's not go beyond. Okay. I think the amount of engagement, for example, by ICWA, by some of the things we have managed to do. In fact, the Roads, Winds and Spices seminar was followed up by the UNESCO connecting with some of us. You were a part of reviving marine archaeology. You would be delighted to know in the NSA trilateral, which happened between Maldives, Sri Lanka and India, out of the long list of defense and policy, because I was asked to give a 2-page brief, marine archaeology has been brought in, which means a collaborative approach, because ecosystem cannot be done by a singular approach and multiple. So there is facts coming. Some of the island nations have better capabilities in undertaking diving. Some of us have had some past experience. Now, with all respect to some of the very eminent maritime archaeologists, we are talking of more than a decade plus gap between the last work done and today. And there are people writing an entire book on marine archaeology without having dived. So we have structural challenges. To us at the MHS, we have put among the focus areas, we have brought in marine archaeology, and we are talking of a 3 to 5 year old journey. One of the big challenges is not just identifying a revival of heritage and bringing consciousness, but having the long game plan for this. The maritime medium is complex. So you need a mix of practitioners, you need a bit of existing scholarship, you need some amount of structure. And the other good news I can share, in the last 1 month, I have had inquiries which have originated from the Ministry of Defense and Ministry of Port Shipping and Waterways for a single thing. Can we set up a Center of Maritime History? So for me, it is like a delight to say, okay, you just tell us where and when and we will come. So there is an interest that is reviving. I think what we need is our initiatives. We can even put, say, what is called small victories. Let's just talk of, say, one connectivity. And I think Project Mawsome was a classic example which we clearly missed the opportunity. Sure. But that doesn't mean we can't bring back what is applicable today. So in closing, with the change from what is called in the Sagar approach and the way we have a recognition and value across the Indian Ocean, we can take that technical or security paradigm to culture, to connectivity, to scholarship, and begin long-term projects. We can't do this 6 months sudden results coming out. I think that is not correct. So we have certain projects. I'll give one example, a nautical journey of India. apart from the Pothis and apart from some work on the Chola navigation package, there is very little fresh work. So we are attempting to do. So I think small bite sizes to start with, which will give us some encouragement, and we should do a long-term journey is, so maybe a collaborative approach is what, this is what we at MHS have set out. I have had scholars working for 2 years before they just qualify to examine further. So those are some responses, but we are committed. And I think many other organizations and even the national leadership is very committed to reviving this.
Thank you, Dr. Raghavan.
No, just a brief comment and really to footnote what you and the director of the Maritime History Society just said. To my mind, you know, this maritime, the absence of a maritime heritage consciousness, which Dr. Rohan referred to, it's certainly there, but how to address it requires that there are certain key, I don't want to use the word pressure points, but that's the word which comes to my mind. I think those pressure points have to be touched. I say this because, for instance, there was a recent report of the Niti Aayog on heritage management. And it's a, I went through it cursorily and I'm not an expert. To my mind, it's a very good report. And certainly more than what the report has, what it signals is the existence of a pressure point. And I would strongly urge you, Dr. Rohan, the others on this panel, and also the director of the MHS, that the points you are making here, please put them into the loop, put it into the, you know, into the Niti Aayog loop in some way. It could just be a email which you repeat to 20 places. But I think this absence of a maritime heritage consciousness, and it's understandable why it is there, because if you look at the continental heritage and so much which remains to be done over there, the fact that maritime heritage is incidental is not surprising. But I do think this Niti Aayog report is a very good place to begin from, to address and to flag the very point which you're making here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Raghavan. And actually, you were part of that journey which started. And thanks to you, we got, you know, that special issue on India Quarterly, which I'm sure went to all the, how should one put it, people who read the Niti Aayog reports as well, or are part of that. I'm trying to see diplomatic words. Unfortunately, I've lived too long in JNU. So it has, I mean, we have tried, haven't we? And, you know, you were the one who encouraged all of this. So I'm hoping that some of this will make a dent somewhere. And really thanking you for the support which started this. Can I request any other questions?
Ma'am, I have a question for Dr.
Yeah,
Rohan.
Please. Yeah.
Dr. Rohan, I must compliment you for a great presentation. I really enjoyed watching it. And you brought out the issue about shipbuilding, you know, which is a very critical element in sea power. And that's often not understood. So the question that I have is that, and correct me if I'm wrong here, reason why they could have access to so much of timber is that, was it because their the geography there did not permit agriculture? Was it that it was a lot of barren land? If not, then did this sort of plantation impact their food security in any manner? Thank you.
Are you asking in context of India, as in like when they came here?
Portuguese.
All right. Yeah. No, it did not have. No, see, the point here is that when the question is about timber for shipbuilding, it becomes a very scientific method of plantation. So when you talk about scientific method of plantation, there are so many things that come into picture. Actually, it is the scientific forestry that gives you better forest cover and also the management of the same. So it has got nothing to do with food security, rather with plantation, the food. For example, I just said that the oak, the same oak would give you firewood as well as the same oak would give you cork. If you see today, 15% of the Portugal's GDP today is because of their forest produce, and that is basically cork. So firewood would go, and that peeling off or pruning of the tree after every 15 years would give you a better wood. 15% girth of the wood would be better. It would be less susceptible to the worms and other things. Now, if you see, this scientific forestry and the whole idea of silviculturist developed through a gradual process. And if you see, most of the communities that survived, because they were pastoralists basically. If you look at 12th century formation of Portugal, most of the people who were pastoralists were actually driven to live in a land which was considered to be the end of Europe. So the argument here is that the people who lived in that particular land already were surviving on the forest. With the coming of the plantation, they were recognized as a class. And that played a very important role in the creation of a middle class, juxtaposed with a mercantile community, which was brought by the Genoese merchants, who were basically privateers. So it actually not impeded, rather complemented the whole process of living. And their living standard also increased. Because there's one of the researchers which tells that after 1415, you see a considerable rise of the middle class population and the lifestyle of the Portuguese in that particular region. So food security was not a problem at that point in time, if I have to put it that way. And if I can take the leverage of extending it, for example, if you want to read, I'll give you a name. If you read F.C. Ford Robertson report, and this was written in 1936, it is Government of India Press. Now he has written a book called Our Forests. Read that book, and then it is just 75 pages, I think 56 pages book. It's a report. It's a report on the forest in the Kumaon region. He gives you an understanding of how the people, the community, actually plays a major role in transforming the forest. And to give you an idea, he says, go on Kumaon, look towards your east and you will see a forest. And look towards your west and you will see Punjab and you will see the bare lands. And that is what of scientific forestry has done to India. So that is how he concludes that how forestry is important, how timber and the understanding of the forest, silviculturalists are important for your growth. That is what actually I wanted to highlight. So that you can read there also, and it will give you an idea with what is happening in India also. Also, to add, Pondy Papers, which was written by Michael Bookie. It is available, I think, at Teen Murthy Library. If you happen to go there, just read it. Marlon Bushi, Pondy Papers. He has talked about the districts of Nasik and the whole forestry around Bombay and Maharashtra and how things were actually put in together so that there is no loss of plantation, plus the food is also insured. So both things have been complementary to each other. I hope I have answered your question. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. I have a question for Dr. Meena. And this is coming from a historian. I'm not an international relations person. The point you made about Panikkar borrowing from Mahan, if I got you right. And my question really comes from reading Panikkar's autobiography, which he wrote in Malayalam and was then translated into English. Now, there he says that, the book India and the Indian Ocean and his the other book, Asia and Western Dominance, he wrote as responses to, say, Guy Wint or to other persons teaching in Oxford. And since you have looked at, in much more detail, my specific question is, Panikkar himself doesn't make a mention of Mahan. So is it us attributing that borrowing, or is it Panikkar's own position that he borrows from Mahan?
Ma'am, that's true, but I think it's quite clearly visible in his work that he is influenced by Mahan. In all his work which I have read, India and the Indian Ocean, it is visible that he's influenced by his work. And ma'am, I'll tell you, by extension, our the National Maritime Doctrine which we have, which was latest in 2015. It has been multiple versions now, from 1994 to 2015 is the latest version. They do not mention Mahan at all, but all the main elements of Mahan's work is there in the National Maritime Doctrine. I think till 2009, they were explicitly mentioning Mahan as a chief influencer of India's maritime doctrine, but they did not mention Mahan in the next one, that is 2015. So, but I think he also borrows a lot from it, not a lot from Mahan, but doesn't actually say that in as many words.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks. So I do not want to give any sort of final statement on this panel, which was both rich and it touched many aspects, except perhaps to make just one point, which came up, I think, in Rohan's paper, Indian Maritime Consciousness. And I think which also came up in Professor Palat's presentation, where he said that the kind of history we study is really based on a European model. And is there an Indian model, or is there something which helps us relate to Asia or an Indian consciousness? And I've often been reminded that one of our key foundational positions on the sea is that of the churning of the ocean, Samudra Manthan. Samudra Manthan, as far as historians go, has been dumped into the dustbin because it's myth and legend and doesn't have any relevance. But I, you know, to my mind, and there are interesting papers on this, on the Samudra Manthan, where scholars have argued as to how one should look at it, and not really as history, but as something which informs our position on the sea, which is that the sea is the repository of riches and not of control. And the only publication that I see, and, you know, I may be wrong, there may be more literature on this, is Rajamohan's paper, where Rajamohan's book on Samudra Manthan, where he talks about the tripartite situation between China, India, and I think the US, with reference to geostrategy. I do think that there's a lot of work ahead, and thank you all on this panel for showing us the possibilities and perhaps the way in which we could take this forward. So with those words, I really thank you. I've enjoyed the morning. And thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you, ICWA.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for moderating the session. Thank you to all the participants for those wonderful presentations and very fruitful discussion as well. So we'll now take a break and we'll reconvene to the fourth session at 1400 hours Indian Standard Time. Bye.